Welcome back to Los Angeles, Italia. This is the last day of our 16th annual Italian Festival in Hollywood. And we are getting closer to the Oscar night. As you can see, you have all the images coming from Union Station, which is going to be the main headquarter of this year's Oscar, instead of Hollywood with the Dolby Theater. The pandemia made the Academy decide to have mainly the Oscar downtown LA, LA Live at the Union Station. And of course, it will be also some other venue. And we're going to talk about it today with so many people who actually are very much involved in the Oscar because of Laura Pausini, a nomination with Diane Warren and Nicola Gagliardi for the song Scene. By the movie The Life Ahead, directed by Edoardo Ponti, and of course the Pinocchio people, Massimo Cantini Parrini, nominated for an Oscar with his amazing costume, and of course the other makeup artist and hairstylist, Dalia Colli, and Francesco Pegoretti, nominated with Marc Coulier. So welcome back to Daniel McVicar, l'Americano a Roma, who has been so nice, so patient to be with me this whole week, telling all about Los Angeles, Italia, from Roma. On the back we have live the Chinese theater, which is not as full as normally is during the Oscar week. Normally we are used to see the image of the Hollywood Boulevard shut it down during these days, the eve of the Oscar. It's all the street blocked normally by the red carpet. This year is a little bit of sadness in Hollywood, although it's sadness all over the world. Daniel.
Well, it's certainly been dispersed this year, the ceremony for the Oscars. We just saw the images of Union Station, where the main ceremonies will take place this year, so that they can socially distance, but everybody can be present that's nominated. But they'll be doing it in shifts. But, you know, people from the movie business, they know how to work together, and they know how to do this. In fact, movies have gone on, certainly during the COVID crisis, by establishing protocols. And it's very active in America, very active here in Italy. Here we see the Chinese theater, where the Los Angeles Italia Festival has gone on this week with great success, showing films in the cinema at the Los Angeles Italia Film Festival.
Yes, of course, we have had a program spread out in three different locations, so the Chinese Theater, then two platforms, eventide.org, which still goes on today with many movies, and I would like to underline the conformist, a classic maestro, Bernardo Bertolucci, who happened to be one of my heroes, and I'm very proud that in 2008 we made possible a star on Walk of Fame for him just because of our nomination. The Hollywood Chamber of Commerce accepted it and was the first star. And today we show his the Conformist a section, the Italian Master that we are making with the Intesa San Paolo Bank as well as Minerva Pictures. Well, actually, dear Daniel, is gonna make this year an incredible project. Gianluca Curti, who actually we're gonna meet later on, is preparing an incredible platform which is dedicated just to Italian cinema, historical cinema, modern cinema. It's called Movie Italy, and we're going to talk later with Gianluca Curti. And then I say that beside eventive.org, which is a Canadian platform, but very much loved by the American people, we have the most beloved Italian platform, mymovies.it, which is highlighting most of the job prepared by so many young filmmakers. But today we start with another type of conversation. Yes, the Oscar, but Italy first of all. Yes, because we have for the moment two amazing guests that has a lot to do with cinema, with beautiful Italia that the whole world loves. And normally at this time of the year in Hollywood, they all talk about their possible holidays in the Naples and Salerno Bay. And with us, we have one of the pioneers of the tourism in Campania region, as well as the owner of the most beautiful hotel and spa on the Mediterranean Sea on the Isle of Ischia, Giancarlo Carriero, who's actually the president of the Campania Hotel manager, let's say. And then we have one institution, legendary figure, loved all over the world. And when she gets to Hollywood, there is beside Lina Wertmüller and Sophia Loren, one only name, very known and very loved, Countess Marina Cicogna. Marina, you should switch on the green, the microphone, because I can't hear your voice. Although I can start hearing Giancarlo Carriero. So welcome, Giancarlo. It's a pleasure to have you here. I say that you are a pioneer of the tourism, not only of cinema, because you've been the co-founder of Ischia Global, the festival which is highlighting the beauty of Campania region, of your amazing hotel. During the summer, it's becoming a destination for all the top Hollywood players. Go, Giancarlo. We don't hear you. You should put on the microphone.
No, I am okay with the microphone.
Now.
Okay. It was about 20 years ago that we started with Ischia Global, almost 20 years ago. We have seen so many wonderful people in Ischia, and I also think we have made them love a little bit our place, because the nature is really gorgeous. I think that really Ischia has a very strong relationship with cinema. The tourism started when Rizzoli arrived to Ischia, and Rizzoli was a very famous publisher, but also movie makers. And so a lot of movies have been shot in Ischia since the early 50s. And all people in Ischia loves to have this kind of people in our place. So I hope that this COVID will end soon, and we will make again all what we are seeing right now with these wonderful people. Because this kind of event really needs people. We can discuss through the internet, but of course we cannot have glamour if we do not have people really in the site. So,
yes, we are seeing some of the people who actually you can have an article video. We've seen some of the people that have been joining the festival. We see Laura Pausini right now that was there. In 2007, as well as our honorary president Tony Renis, Andrea Bocelli, Dave Foster, and Umberto Gatica with the wonderful Nicoletta Mantovani and Trudy Styler. We honored, you remember, Giancarlo, Maestro Pavarotti was his latest appearance just on The Voice before he unfortunately died. It was like very emotional, but we are been seeing here in Bocelli, the Rosario Dawson, we saw so many huge talent, Claire Dance, Clive Davis, Forest Whitaker, Christoph Waltz with the legendary Italian director Ettore Scola, and then Il Volo for her first appearance. What a magic moment with Bud Spencer, Trudy Styler, Maria Grazia Cucinotta, Carlo Bucirosso, you with Carlo Verdone, Oliver Stone, Remo Girone, Ivan Cotroneo, you again, Liv Schreiber with, you see, Nicoletta, Tony Renis, again, so many, Angela Bassett, Elsa Zilberstein, Kid Creel and the Coconuts, the magic moment that Alfonso Cuarón, we saw before, Alejandro González Iñárritu, again, Lina Wertmüller, many people, I mean, I can count, Hilary Swank, Billy August, a phenomenal duet, Sting and Zucchero, again, Lucio Dalla with Eli Roth and Gino Paoli, then Anthony Mackie, just became Captain America for the superheroes, Raul Bova with Laura Morante, Giancarlo Giannini, Wow, how many? Sherry Crow Zucchero, again, the maestro, the maestro, and then Monica Bellucci, who's actually has a movie running for the Oscar, Mark Anton Jamming, Matteo Garrone, Gerard Butler, who arrived for first time in Ischia in 2004, nobody knew, but you made him very popular, yeah. Samuel Jackson, they came to see to promote the Turbo. Then we saw Baz Luhrmann again. Well, this is like amazing, phenomenal. Paul Allen, who the famous tycoon co-founder of the Microsoft, who died. Lee Daniels, who has a movie here that Ted Sarandos, his first appearance in Italy was for introducing Netflix. Ellen Mirren again. Wow, how many? The president of the Academy, past honorable president of Campania Region, De Luca. Well, I should go back to live. Let's go back live. Giancarlo, what have we seen? It's amazing, incredible. This is a miracle.
I remember any single moment of this wonderful gallery that we had. So really proud of this. And you did not show the performing by Zucchero and Sting. And
no, Bocelli. It came out. It was very fast, but it came out. I told you, Zucchero and Sting. It was coming out. It was, okay, fun, phenomenal. I see that the Marina, you are there? No, Marina, devi mettere il microfono acceso. Dovete accendere il microfono. Ci sei, Marina? È un pulsante verde. Nicoletta Ercole, welcome.
Hi, you can hear me?
Can you hear me? I can hear you. Marina, you there? Marina, dovresti accendere il microfono. So, Giancarlo, I mean, this is an incredible turnout of people.
Dove sta il microfono?
You see? Bene, bene, ci siamo, Marina. Meno male, sei rientrata. Ok. So, Giancarlo, was talking about this incredible turnout of people.
Ma dove andiamo? Andiamo di là?
Marina,
sì, dimmi Pascal.
Ecco, so you saw the video of the past edition of the past 18 edition of Ischia Global. This year we celebrate the 19. So Giancarlo, it was a miracle to make it happen, no?
It was a really huge effort, and it was really, I think, something. Unforgettable for me personally, for the island. It is something that really is unbelievable. We did a wonderful job, and I'm really proud, especially proud for all this.
Mettiamoci di là, vai.
Ecco,
così
lo
Hello. So this was I mean a lot of work, but the satisfaction to see that Ischia got back on the map of the jet set, because after Rizzoli left, this was desire of you and of your family. First of all, your father Leonardo Carriero, to bring back Ischia to the magic moment of the island.
Yes, and I think really we are living right now a very good moment for the island. Ischia is reported by all the best travel magazines like Travel and Leisure or Condé Nast Traveler, and always mentioned as one of the best places to go. And I think that part of the good job is due to what we did with the festival.
Marina Cicogna. So it's we can say that now Capri is not alone anymore, but Ischia is a big deal in Hollywood.
Well, you know, Capri has never been alone, but Ischia is always, I mean, it's always great. You know how much I love to go there. I love to go even out of season and everything. And of course, this Ischia has been so popular that every actor, every director that we have invited has always come. So it's a huge, huge success right from the beginning.
Yes, Nicoletta, Italy is welcoming back all the international friends and the international fan. A few minutes ago, I had here the privilege to welcome in our studio Jack Houston. Actually, was honored in Ischia with the Bud Spencer Award by Giancarlo Carriero a few years ago, and he's ready to come back on July 18, 2025. No, Italy, it's the place to be during the summer, as you know, so many Hollywood stars. No,
Nicoletta.
Okay. Absolutely. Absolutely. I think that your idea is the best idea and to promote the cinema in the world, because Capri and Ischia, there's a magical island. And I have been there with you twice or three times many years ago, and was very exciting. I think that this edition, it's really emotional, because we are all together, but not together physically. But I think with our heart and with our mind, we are more closer. We are closer than before, you know.
We have to tell that even last year when the pandemic started, we had an amazing festival, smaller of course, but with our co-board member Trudy Styler, as well as Giancarlo Carriero, of course, Marina Cicogna, Tony Renis, Franco Nero, the three musketeers, as we used to call. We made the festival happen. We worked very, very close with the Minister of Health, and what we will do this year as well. We worked very, very close with the Italian Red Cross, Croce Rossa Italiana, and we made everything in a proper way. Actually, Ischia Global was a model of a restart. And also this year will be very much seen all over as a place to be. I had before, as I said, Jack Houston, that is ready to come. He wants to bring his aunt Angelica Houston and his uncle Danny Houston. Giancarlo, the myth of Ischia is matching in the global imagination of with the Italian dream. Normally we talk about the American dream, but in the summer, of course, there is an Italian dream all over the world, and specifically a Naples Bay and Salerno Bay dreams, no?
Yes, and we are really ready to start again the season. I hope that people from all over the world will start traveling soon. We have also something new to show in Ischia. We have even a wonderful submarine now to show the beautiful nature underneath the sea, and not only over the sea. And luckily we are, the government is doing something really interesting, because the people of all the small islands, including Ischia, of course, will be fully vaccinated in a very short time. So everything will be ready in a short time to welcome again people from all over the world, US especially, of course.
Yes, absolutely. I think that is right into the room also. Gianluca Isaiah, who's actually working with us also in Los Angeles so much, is one of the supporters of this year festival in Los Angeles, as it was in the past. Gianluca, you made of the Naples dream a big deal with all your Neapolitan line, bringing back the Neapolitan tradition worldwide with your brand. So it's Napoli, it has nothing anymore to be complained for, no? Gianluca, devi accendere il microfono.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now yes.
Okay, sorry. So Napoli is full of energy even after a crazy, you know, year like that, more than a year. Personally, I think that I miss very much to be in Los Angeles. I miss your festival in Los Angeles. So I really hope it will be possible to go back again soon, you know?
Absolutely, we all hope. Mark Bikindu is a producer that actually came to Ischia. He met Billy August, and then he found a book that was taking care, that was written by Eri De Luca, and he bought the right of the movie for the movie of this book, and now he's preparing a movie with Billy August by a book of Eri De Luca. Yesterday we made a meeting here with Daniel, Eri De Luca, and Billy August, and they're ready to make this movie. Mark, are you ready to find a lot of money to for this movie? We want a bigger movie.
Yes, and thanks for Ischia and the festival, because we all met together at your place during the festival, and we swear that we will do a movie all together, and we find a way to vote the right novel, which happened in Ischia, by the way, on Billy say yes to for directing the script that we are working on, and now we will go back to Ischia, but for a long time.
To shoot a movie.
At least 8 weeks plus the festival. It will be nice.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we hope to welcome you soon. Marina Cicogna, the Countess, Ischia has been magic when Luchino Visconti was living in Villa La Colombaia, but then with the job that Giancarlo Carriero and his family did with the Regina Isabel Hotel is a dream, a living dream, no?
Giancarlo Carriero's hotel has always been, for me, the absolute dream place in Ischia. Although, as I say, I spent a couple of summers when Luchino had bought that piece of land and built his own house and a small house near it, and had filled it with all this kind of object, mostly Liberty style and everything. So it was another Ischia at the time, very, very popular and all that. But I mean, we brought, when we opened the Ischia Film Festival, we brought a whole new life to Ischia, which was more sort of aristocratic and a lot of, Enrico Edassi, a lot of princes, a lot of people there had houses. But now, we have the aristocracy of the world, which is the show people, the all the great directors and actors and all the people who really like all of, that Naples Bay with the most beautiful islands in the world and the nicest people and the best food, and with the fact that we all see movies that are in this huge, beautiful screen that the hotel has, that, sort of lies on top of the sea, on top of the most extraordinary sea, and at night, I mean, it really is the most extraordinary, romantic, and beautiful place in the world. I mean, it's really great.
So, Giancarlo, I have to tell you something that is coming in my mind right now, and you have to listen. Marina, you have to listen too, because this is very important. So, watching the video that was prepared of the past edition of Ischia, I realized that in 2007, we had Alejandro González Iñárritu and Alfonso Cuarón, who actually won the Oscar afterward. Then we have Hilary Swank, Oliver Stone, Paul Haggis, and many others that has won the Oscar. Now, I remember that the night Marina Cicogna honored at Regina Isabella Alfonso Cuarón, on that night, the same night, Giancarlo, Laura Pausini was honored. Now, so he's the only one missing the famous Academy Award. So it's very important that we all stay focused for Sunday night. What do you think?
And of course, you do not forget, but didn't mention other people like Christopher Waltz, who was in Ischia.
About this specific year, 2007, eh? This is the reason.
Yes. And so we really bring luck to people. And so this is we invite so many people because we want to bring them luck and win the Oscars. And we're happy that they
Marina Cicogna, sometimes you are being honoring people that you barely know, and you say, Pascal, you are crazy, you make me honor people, you don't even explain me who is these people. Now, did you know when in 2007 I made you honor Regina Isabella Alfonso Cuarón, that he was a hell of a director going to be an Hollywood legend after a while? Or was just one of these people that I begged you to honor, and maybe it was not popular at all when we honored, as I say, mentioned Gerard Butler, who came in 2004 and nobody knew. So did you know Alfonso Cuarón when I asked you to honor him?
Pascal, we didn't know these people at the time. I don't know why you honored them, because we didn't know them. They were not famous yet. And of course, what we their presence in Ischia has always been very, very luck-bringing. I mean, these people became very famous afterwards. It's of course, we had some very well-known people who were already famous, but the fact of having young directors, young actors, many more than you actually even mentioned. I can't remember exactly their names, but I mean, we brought them luck. You know, that's always great. I mean, it's always great to think that a place like that is opening doors for great talents who are yet to reveal themselves to the world. And maybe we were lucky to know and to think that they had a chance, but certainly at the time, no one much knew them. So, I mean, I think that place in Ischia altogether, that's why I also like to go. It brings a lot of energy to one. It sort of opens up doors. It is a very positive atmosphere, and everybody seems to be relaxed and in a good mood, which is nice, but also full of plans, full of ideas for the future, and it's like an opening door. It really is, and it's great to be like that. That it's great that a place can be that, and it is. I don't know, but that doesn't depend on us. That depends on the energy of that extraordinary island.
So, Gianluca Isaia, among the big talents we've been honoring in the past edition of Ischia Global, we definitely honored a few giants. I remember Marina Cicogna inviting her friend Valentino. I remember you honoring the legendary Vivienne Westwood. So when Neapolitan style meets British crazy style of music. So how was for you meeting Vivienne Westwood?
Oh, Vivian, yes.
It was very emotional because I had the opportunity to, you know, to spend some time with her, and she was apart of that, she was very, very sweet. She was really in passion, still in passion, what she did for her life, and that was, I think, a very, very, you know, emotional for me. But can I add something, Pascal? Can I add something?
Yes.
So, listening to all the huge luck that Ischia bring to all the people that has been honored by your festival, I think and I suggest that soon you should honor me in Ischia as a testimonial of the Neapolitan fashion, because in the near future we need a lot of luck, you know, after the pandemic. So I'm waiting for your invitation. Thank you.
Okay, so Gianluca, so you'll be one of this year honoree for sure, absolutely.
But thank you.
Talking about fashion, Nicoletta.
Can I tell you something?
Yes, I want to ask you a specific question about before we were talking with Marina Cicogna about Villa La Colombaia in Forio and Luchino Visconti. When I think about Luchino Visconti, I think about Piero Tosi, the legendary Piero Tosi. And when I think about Piero Tosi, I think now about Massimo Cantini Parrini, who was his assistant, his student, and now he's up for a nomination. So Massimo Cantini Parrini is one of the most talented new costume designer worldwide. What is your opinion? Is he going to make the Oscar?
The question is for Marina or for me?
For you.
For me, okay. So first, he's a student of Piero. I started to work with Piero as assistant in Luchino Visconti movie, L'Innocente. Then, you know, Piero is Piero. And Massimo is a great student. I hope that he wins because my heart, he's represent Italy as Francesco Pegoretti, as Dalia Colli. So they are the best in this moment in Italy. But I must tell you something. I would that Massimo wins, of course. I love him. He worked with me too as assistant once many years ago. But I think that Anne Roth, they said one of the best costume designer, American costume designer. She's 90 this year. So she made a little movie, fantastic movie. I don't know if you saw it. It's Ma Rainey Black Bottom. She just made few costumes, not a lot, but so great, so young, so incredible that maybe could be the last Oscar. Massimo has a future in front of him. You know, he's starting now. He is the best, and I wish that he really win. But I will be very happy if Andrew could win her last Oscar Academy Award. That's my opinion.
He is, this is the real challenge for Massimo, this movie, eh?
For Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, and that's the word also that I've heard a lot, but still, though, his Massimo's work in Pinocchio is extraordinary, simply extraordinary, as well as the makeup and the hair. For that film, the whole look, the whole world that they created inside this film is there's a reason it's nominated. And it can be maybe a dark horse, maybe a red horse. Let's just call it a red horse because there was a lot of red in the film. And it has a great shot and we're cheering for it. But also, I think Laura Pausini, a lot of people are talking about that. But maybe the same reason that they're talking about Ma Rainey's Black Bottom is Laura Pausini worked with Diane Warren to compose this song. And Diane Warren has been nominated 12 times. This is the 12th nomination and has never won.
And Diane Warren is a super friend of Valeria Altobelli. Abbiamo le immagini di Diane Warren premiata, sono le immagini 2020. So Valeria Altobelli actually told me something that it's a secret. So we are a few friends, we can tell about this secret. We see on the stage, this is not Diane Warren, this is
Danny Houston.
Okay.
Angelica Houston.
Yeah, Angelica Houston. No, but going back to Valeria Altobelli, andiamo in diretta su Valeria Altobelli, ragazzi, non perdiamo tempo che non trovate le immagini. Questo è Ezio Greggio e con questa è Francesca Archibugi, Los Angeles l'anno scorso. Eccola finalmente, Diane Warren con Silvia Chiave e Marta De Laurentiis. I want to say my love to Marta De Laurentiis, also to Elisa Moruso. This is an image, Maylin Aguirre. This is an image of last year. Diane Warren was honored by the Consul General of Italy at the Los Angeles Italia Festival 2020. This was the this was the opening gala on February 2nd when the pandemia was just starting in Japan. I remember listening the news of the big ship docked in the Tokyo Harbor with an Italian hero, a capitano of the big cruise ship company that was handling this complicated situation of the pandemic. And this was just the beginning. We were in Los Angeles. The Americans were not at all aware of this while the Oscar was going to happen. And even on February 9th, we can see maybe Leonardo DiCaprio while he was on the Oscar carpet on February 9th. Nobody could ever imagine that this pandemia was going to be, you know, crapping the whole world. However, I was telling you about Diane Warren, and there is a friend, very close friend with us of Diane Warren. She calls her sister, and she's Valeria Altobelli, who's actually a very talented actress, singer, celebrity worldwide. And so, Valeria, you told me a secret. You want to repeat the secret you told me about this song?
Of course I do. And thank you for the presentation, Pascal, and for the kind word. And I was remembering, you know, that as you told just, you know, few time ago, as we were in Los Angeles, we were not aware of what was going on because I arrived just after Diane and we were celebrating this beautiful night at, you know, Chinese theater without knowing anything of what, you know, will happen in a few days. I remember me traveling with the mask, but I was like a pioneer because they were watching me in a very strange way. But you were telling something, and yes, I'm very, you know, happy to share with you this story because it's not a secret at all. But, you know, I was telling you because actually nobody knows, because, you know, I'm very caring about the people that are my friends. And as you told Diane, she's a very close friend of mine. I'm so honored of this beautiful friendship because we had the possibility last year of working on two beautiful projects. One project was worldwide against violence on women, and so she gave me this beautiful song nominated for the Oscars last year, that is I'm Standing With You, sang by Christy Met. And me, I am the president of this worldwide association against violence on women and children. So she gave me her baby, her song, to let all my women from all over the world go to her studio in Los Angeles and realize this beautiful video worldwide. And we were interviewed with our close friend John Debney on CNN, me, Diane, and John, and it was just a beautiful emotion. And after that, we had another beautiful project with her because she wanted me to represent Italy with the beautiful project she made for WHO and YouTube and the United Nations against the pandemic, to support all the doctors and all the men and women in front, you know, working against this pandemic for us, for the entire world. So she realized with Tony Levy, Tina Guo, beautiful international artists, and I involved my close friend Sumi Jo, that you honored as well in Ischia. And, you know, we realized this beautiful anthem worldwide with 70 artists from all over the world, and she gave me the beautiful possibility of representing Italy. And on billboards, I was in front of Milano Duomo, you know, representing this beautiful land that is our land, that is Italy. And after that, she came to me, you know, in the day of July, I remember exactly. And she told me, you know, Valeria, I'm working on a project, on a beautiful project I really care about, because it's a movie with Sophia Loren that she really loves and appreciates. And they asked me to do a song for this beautiful movie. And, you know, they have this artist. And what do you think among the artists? And among the artists, there was the name of Laura Pausini. And of course, you know, I know that she's super national popular, as we say, like Sophia Loren is. I mean, they are two beautiful women, two talented women, two women that are really self-made women. So they represented artistically, which was their character, their behaving, their attitude. And so when I saw Laura Pausini's name, I told Diane, yes, Diane, I think this is the right choice. I mean, the other artists, I don't want to tell the name, you know, you are, you know, in, let's say, in a struggle, she is in a struggle with, let's say, an artistical struggle. She's amazing. But Laura Pausini, she's really national popular. So I think that she can embody in music what Sophia Loren embodies in movies and in cinema for us that are Italian. So, you know, when I saw all the development of the things, and when I remember it was November and this amazing song with this beautiful movie came out, I was just freaking out because, you know, I remember this, you know, confidence between friends, you know, and then I saw the nomination and then the Golden Globe. So I was texting Diane almost every day because, you know, we are really, really close after these two projects that we did really for free. And I want to tell you that Diane is an absolutely amazing human being. So she did this project I cooperated to, and one that I, you know, created by zero without, how can I say, asking for anything. She just gave her studio, she just gave her art. So she really deserved the best, as Daniel McVicker was telling and all the beautiful guests were telling, because, you know, she's just a pure human being, you know, better than me, Pascal. She lives with their animal in the ranch. She saves animals from the street, and she is a truly, how can I say, caring person about, you know, all the issues and the problems. I mean, she lives on her own, on her room, creating what she can do. So it's her music. But she's a true, true friend. And she demonstrates it to me. You know, I'm, you know, a nobody, just a girl coming from Italy, thanks to John Debney, asking her, Diane, can we do this project of an international anthem against violence together? And she just was so happy, so, you know, and just an humble person like her that deserves all the beauty of this world, all the good, you know, with the capital G, like Plato used to say, only she can win an Oscar in a year like that, speaking of somebody's that are nobody's, that nobody can see, that nobody can hear, because she's really, how can I say, a smooth voice, a caring voice. And Laura Pausini, she's just amazing. I mean, when she speaks about in Sanremo as well, when she speaks about their story and their dad, and the way she comes from nowhere, I see a hope for this future and for young artists and young, you know, songwriters and singers, because she really gives the hopes. She never sold herself. She never, you know, she never compromised. She just brought to the world her talent, and her talent is a gift of God, as for Diane. So when we understand our talents and when we can give, you know, to the world what God put it in our hearts, this is the way to go. So best of wishes to these beautiful women. And because it's like a trinity, you know, Sophia, Diane and Laura, it's just a united entity. So, you know, they deserve really this Oscar, because it's women time, as you were telling, as Nicoletta and Marina were telling, it's women time. So this will tell a lot. After 12 nomination, this will tell a lot for Diane, and she really cares about it, you know, to the Golden Globes. And she's like the Susan Lucci of, you know, the music, but she really deserves it. And I can tell you, because as I told you, I share the most beautiful thing you can share with the person, that is friendship. So I really can tell how deep and special this woman is.
So thank you, Valeria, for your contribution. Watching the image of a past Ischia Global Festival edition, it came back on my mind when Aldo Arcangeli was asked by Tony Renis to go and pick up in the Naples Harbor Jimmy Iovine, who actually is in Italian Jimmy Iovine, but in America, one of the most successful producer of music. And he first signed the U2, he first signed Jay-Z, he first signed many of the rappers. He's one of an icon for all the rapper musician. Is called Iovine because they pronounce Iovine. So when Aldo Arcangeli went with his boat to pick up Jimmy Iovine, he became an icon for Jimmy Iovine, who actually whenever sees Aldo in Los Angeles, have a lot of fun. They remind the riding on the Naples Bay waves with his boat. No, Aldo?
Yes, we had a really, really great time with Jimmy. As you know, Jimmy is, I think he's Ruth is from Ischia. And we really spent a couple of days on a boat, and he really enjoyed the time. And he's always in touch with me, and it was a great opportunity for me to meet him. And Ischia, it is a land of great opportunity. And Pascal, as you know, it was a really, really good time.
Giancarlo, we heard a very weird news that the American are supposedly they are not suggesting to their citizens to fly over Italy so far, because it seems that it's a still dangerous country. So what can we tell in order to convince both the American government and also the sceptic people all over the world that to come to fly to Italy and to have a behaved attitude, they can enjoy our touristic excellences as in the past.
I think that maybe during last year, we in Italy did not do everything in the best way. But in last months, things are quite changing in best. I mean, for example, the vaccination campaign is running fast, even faster than other countries in Europe. And I think there are all situation is going better and better. I really don't understand why the U.S. government said that it's still dangerous to come in Italy. I'm quite confident that it is just something that happened now because of past months' news, but they will change their mind quite soon. Anyway, we are ready, as always, to welcome people from all over the world and U.S. citizens mainly. We have our food ready for them. We have our best things. We have our fashion that really had wonderful news to show. And we have all our, may I say, sympathy to show to the American people. And So I think that just we are ready to do everything. The airports are ready to start again all the flights from US. So I think it would be quite soon that everything will be not normal, but will become much, much better.
Mark Bikindu, what makes Ischia Global different in front of the other festivals, such as Cannes Film Festival, such as Venice Film Festival? I mean, this is a unique event, they say. Why for you it's a unique event?
Okay. Well, for the... I came in Ischia for the first time, I think, two years ago, before the pandemic, and all my friends from Los Angeles told me, you have to come with us, you have to come with us. This is fantastic, because we are going, as you know, everywhere in the world for promoting our movie, especially with Avi Lerner, which I used to work for 20 years. And he told me at the time, for me, it's the best place you should go. And the first time I came in Ischia, it was a shock for me, because in other festival or otherwise in the world, it's very, how can we say that? It's not really friendly, you know, because all the time you have, many people to talk to somebody, you have to talk to the press agency, to that. And basically, it's difficult to meet people and to create friendship anywhere in the world, in a festival so much as Cannes. Berlin is a little different because it's very cold and you cannot go out. You all the time go from one hotel room to another hotel lobbies and everything. And Ischia was really, really a big something that I discovered and I keep in my heart for the rest of my life, because it's fantastic and we are doing a movie, you know, because of that. And because you can talk and to present yourself and to meet people and to create new thing. And it's fantastic. Pascal, you found it's a good combination between music, art, people, film, and it's very rare, and we have to keep that because it's fantastic.
The music is a very important session because of our honorary president, Tony Renis, but also because Giancarlo Carriero is a big jazz lover. By the fact that he also organized a very important event at the end of August, the Piano Jazz, who actually brings the global excellences of jazz. I personally remember seeing an amazing George Benson concert at that time at the Negombo Arena, but there have been so many huge moments, and of course this is the land of Stefano Bollani and Danilo Rea with Gino Paoli. This is all exclusive show that you can join in Ischia at the end of August, no Giancarlo?
Yes. Thank you for mentioning this, but I think that art and holiday are quite good together. And so I love music, but especially I love cinema, and this is why I really am happy and proud that we can show this kind of performances to our guests, and also to show the beautiful island to people, to artists, to real artists, both in music and in movies, so in cinema. So I'm quite happy for this.
So Gianluca, you are one of the ambassadors of the Neapolitan Men Style worldwide with your brand Isaia, actually was founded by your father Enrico Isaia. So being a Neapolitan ambassador worldwide, what makes the difference between the Neapolitan style and the other brand style? Why does the Neapolitan style is so much loved by the global most important executives or a tycoon all over the world? I mean, they come from all over to Casalnuovo, or maybe where you created an amazing franchise. Talking about Hollywood, do you have a wonderful shop which is an incredible building in Beverly Hills? So in the America, how many shops branded there are?
In America, yeah, now we just opened in Chicago during the pandemic. So now we have four stores, one in New York, and the other two, San Francisco and Beverly Hills. But I think that the difference is mainly in the passion that the Neapolitan artisans put into the garments. I'm not talking just about Isaia, but all the Neapolitan sartoria. And I think that the final consumer can feel, I always say that they can feel the heart and soul that our artisans' hands put when they sew the garments. I think it's the main reason. I think it's the main reason.
Who made an amazing job with the Neapolitan style is Daniela Ciancio, who actually was the custom designer for the Paolo Sorrentino masterpiece, The Great Beauty. I remember Daniela joining us also at Los Angeles, Italia, that year. And Daniela, congratulations for your amazing job, Italian tradition in custom design and in style all over is renewed, and you're one of the most successful contemporary ambassadors. So what do you want to add what Gianluca Isaia said about, I mean, Jeff Gambardella was an Attolini's jacket, but you made all the other customs. Daniela?
Can you hear me, Pascal?
Yes, I can hear you.
Hi. Hello.
Yes, I can hear you, okay. But you don't have a connection, Daniela.
First of all, thank you to invite. Sorry, but I don't. Today is. I hope.
I think you may have a shaky connection coming in and out.
Thank you. Sorry.
So it doesn't work.
Can
no,
you,
Aldo, to sell Neapolitan style all over the world, it's easy, no? I mean, starting from the end of May until the end of September, everybody wants to join Napoli, and it's a touristy purse, no? Aldo.
Okay.
Can you hear me, Aldo?
Yes, of course, I can hear you. Hi, Pascal. Good day to everybody. Before I had no chance to say hi to all the friends I see in this platform, and Pascal, you're doing a really great job, and this festival is really a great opportunity for all of us to change opinion. And of course, we are waiting for all of you in Ischia this coming July. And I was listening to Giancarlo, which I say hi, regarding to this alarm that the U.S. Embassy is giving on Italy, which I have to say I was really, really, not say disappointed, but really strangely impressed, because I never heard nothing of so dangerous in our area, in our country, as for this alarm. With regards to the fashion, of course, in Napoli, it is a place where everybody wants to be in the summer. Our islands are all COVID-free. As you know, Pascal, the region is working very hard to make sure that everything's safe. So I really hope that this coming summer, business, tourists will come back as it was. Our airport used to have millions of passengers, And as you know, this year was terrible for all the business. So we really need, we really deserve that we get our status that we really had, we had before.
So, Valeria, talking about music, beside Laura Pausini, Napoli has a big tradition in music, of course. The Neapolitan music is actually the most popular music worldwide, although maybe as individuals, there are other legends from other countries, from other sections, but in classic, Napoli is leading all over, no?
Yes, we were speaking about Giancarlo, and you were speaking about jazz, and I was thinking about the funky that actually was born in Naples, because thanks to Napoli Centrale, Pino Daniele, you know, they were really pioneers in this kind of music. James Senese playing with him. I mean, it's just a natural born land for arts, because, you know, when you have this beautiful sea, when you have this beautiful and positive, not in the meaning, you know, we are keen on listening it today, but this, you know, very easygoing people connecting the dots and putting all the things together, as you do, Pascal, because I want to go back to what they were telling before. And it's true, because, you know, I went to several festivals all over the world, in China, in whatever, in France, in the Balkans. But what you did is just unique, because, you know, you can connect people in friendship. And when you feel good with people, you can, of course, you know, try to think to work with them, because it's just a natural, how can I say, consequence. So, you know, and yes, the music, it's a very important, and I cannot, you know, thank you enough. When the last year that I was with you all, you gave me the possibility to sing in front of Bob Geldof. You know, I was searching exactly that year to create this international anthem. And you, Pascal, only you, you put me in front, a living legend, the one who created the Live Aid on my birthday, so the 13th of July, 1985. So exactly the day I was born. And, you know, you gave me this possibility to sing in front of him. He was presenting this beautiful documentary on life, on the life of Yeats, the poet from Ireland that was known all over the world and for whom he had a great, great passion. So after presenting, you know, this beautiful documentary, you just sent me on stage, and I was with my guitar, and, you know, the most beautiful thing I could do that moment was to dedicate to him a song from greatest Irish like him, that was Dolores O'Riordan, that just passed it. But you were speaking about jazz, and you don't, I will give you another news, you know. And after, you know, Laura Pausini sing, and me and Diane started talking, because she loved the way this beautiful song went out in Italian. She loved the musicality. You were talking about musicality of our language, that is basically, you know, and Napolitan's accent is even more musical than the Italian accent itself. So, you know, Diane gave me this beautiful song that was a pop song, beautiful song, really an unknown song, you know, it's un inedito, we call it, so not edited song. And I arranged it with some people that Giancarlo and you should know, that is Dario Rosciglione and, you know, Gatto, etc., and Enrico Solazzo, that made this beautiful movie this year on Life of Nada. And we arranged Diane's song in a jazz way. So I translated it in Italy, and it came out, because jazz is my passion as well. I mean, we have, you know, poor our as artists, we have to do pop, because it's what, you know, the world cares about. But in our souls, we are all classical. You know, behind me, there is a piano. There are three guitars. So, you know, I come from classical music at all, totally. And I love jazz, of course, as all the singers love to do. So I arranged and adapted this beautiful song of Diane Warren in Italian with the wife of Dario Rosciglione, that is a very famous writer from Sardinia, and we adapted this song in a jazz version, an Italian song, you know, very, very beautiful. So let's see what will happen for the future for this beautiful song that is a jazz song. So I'm in love with jazz.
Yeah, maybe you might go to the next edition of Piano Jazz invited by Giancarlo. But there is Daniel who has a question for Giancarlo.
I'm very passionate about Italian cooking, but more passionate than me is Stanley Tucci, who was there with you in 2004. At your magical place there in Ischia. And now he's going all around Italy and he's talking about the cucina ischitana. And what did he get that from you? He stole it from you.
No, sorry. I did not hear.
No, Stanley Tucci, who's now celebrating the Ischia kitchen, the Ischia cucina, Ischia cuisine. He learned it all from you, from your family.
Ah, no. He went to another restaurant. We will go together next time you will come to Ischia. So come soon. Don't be afraid about flights, and I'll show you where it is. Okay.
but it's very funny that Stanley Tucci came to be honored in 2004. And now he, on CNN, he did this beautiful piece about Coniglio all'Ischitana.
Yes. It was in a very nice restaurant that is in Casamicciola next to Barano on the hill. I want to bring you there. And so I will show you the real Coniglio all'Ischitana. It's
when I come down, we can do that.
No, but Giancarlo, so you have three restaurants in Regina Isabella, but it's a very, very cool, the whole island, because it's very difficult to eat bad in your island. It's very difficult to don't feel at home. This is because of Ischia welcoming people of Ischia, very, very passionate, very welcoming, they hug the people arriving. No, this is their style.
Yes, it is like this. And also because the cuisine that we have is both a cuisine from the sea, because we, of course, are an island, but also from the mainland, because we have a very, very strong tradition in the countryside of the island. So we have a mix of both sea and country, and the rabbit is, of course, from the country. And so I have to show many things, or to make you taste many special things, Daniel. So please come back to Ischia early.
So, Mark, you have been living so much time in New York. Then you were supposed to move to London. All of a sudden, you visited Roma, and you decide, I'm not going to move to London, but I move to Roma. Now, as smart as you are, there are so many other huge artists and producers. I want to mention two big musicians. One is an historical ambassador of Tuscany, Sting, and his wife, Trudy Styler. Actually, Trudy is an ambassador of Ischia, the best Giancarlo promoter worldwide, Trudy Styler. And another one is Mr. Mick Jagger, who actually is living right now in Sicily. So you are one of these guys that realized how cool is the Italian life.
Yes, and that's very funny that you tell me that, because Italy becomes the center of the world. Maybe because of the pandemic, or I don't know, but we were talking about that with a friend from New York.
on from London, and you say everybody now decide to come to Italy to live and to change a life. And what it was strange to me and from other people who are living in New York or to big cities, before the pandemic, it was set up before the pandemic to come back from US to Europe because of that. It was a very difficult time in America before the pandemic. Everybody was against each other, you know, for political reasons. You know, they were two blocks on it. You couldn't stay, live. I couldn't live that way between enemies. You know, it was difficult. And now in Italy, now even with a lot of problem, people love each other. What is there's no enemy. You are not the enemy of somebody else. You know, which is very, very, very nice. You know. And what's strange, you told me that because I got Mick Jagger, you know, friend on the phone who lives in Sicily. And they told me, Mick, you should stop back in Sicily to meet us because we spent so good time down there. You have to bring back Oliver from Rome. I hope we will be able to invite them for the next festival in July.
Absolutely. Daniela, I hope your line is doing well now. So again, Neapolitan style conquered back the Hollywood. I mean, many talents walk on the red carpet with Gianluca Isaiah close, but you brought Neapolitan style through The Great Beauty, directed by Paolo Sorrentino.
Thank you, first of all. Thank you. Pascal, because it's always a pleasure to be with you, to enjoy you and all your clients, all your guests. Neapolitan style is something really hard to explain in words, but I think it's something that we have in our blood. You know, we have a special style, especially on men, of course, men styles. And it's always really interesting to work with this on the actors, from my point of view, of course. And I love the collaboration with all the Neapolitan brands because we can have a really good relation and create something really special. And about the Jap, he can only wear Neapolitan style because in the story he went from Naples, but he must wear colors, but the only way in which we can use colors on a man without be funny, for me, from my point of view, was to use the Neapolitan classical man elegance in the summer, no? With a neutral base, and white trousers, white shirt, and some color jacket. Normally they use the pale blue or blue, but this was the only, this was the idea. In this way, it was so, Neapolitan, but also colored and right in his rule.
Gianluca, Isaiah, normally on Saturday before the Oscar, all the stars keep going in Beverly Hills to make their dress. So many people has been visiting your amazing store in Beverly Hills during these days, and I'm asking you if still this year with the situation like that you we'll have somebody walking on red carpet wearing Isaiah.
I think we are going to have a couple of them, but I cannot tell you who because they don't want, you know, to say anything in advance. But yes, in Beverly Hills, we have a lot of them coming to the store, and they are all. Great people. I think that one that I really love that is wearing our style is Robert Downey Jr. and especially because I think he really represents 100% our ID. So to be very elegant, but at the same time with a touch of contemporary and a touch of irony and self-irony. And in this is really great.
I personally remember a few names in the past wearing Isaiah, Will Smith, Paul Feig, Al Pacino, yeah. And many others. So this is Isaiah from Napoli. Now, there is a gentleman that came from Napoli, moved a long time ago from Italy, established in Los Angeles, and keep making his legend growing. This gentleman was called Dino De Laurentiis. Now, Dino De Laurentiis is unfortunately dead. His wife is still doing the job producer, but the De Laurentiis name is still big because of Aurelio De Laurentiis, who is the niece of Dino De Laurentiis, and his son, Luigi De Laurentiis, who actually is a producer that was raised in Los Angeles at the USC, University of Southern California, the amazing school where used to teach Steven Spielberg, Robert Zemeckis, and also is led by Dean Elizabeth Daly. And Luigi was raised as a producer over there, although he's focusing more on Italian country, although he has been raised as an international producer. Luigi, what's the matter? You left Hollywood.
Ciao Pascal, hello everybody. I left Hollywood in fact because my father, when I graduated, thought to buy the Napoli soccer team, and so I was supposed to stay in the States to develop our American company, but at the time he called me back to Italy and I started producing there. And so in the last 17 years, I've been producing around 23 movies for the Italian market. And we just started with our first TV series for Amazon that we're starting to shoot in mid-May. And at the same time, I've been coming to LA every year and I'm starting to develop some international projects again. So finally, we'll be back in the States a little more.
To be educated, to be a producer, at USC.
Yeah, USC was a great university. I moved to LA when I was 18, and it was end of 1997. I graduated in 03, and then I've been coming ever since. I mean, USC is one of the top film schools in the world, probably number one in the States. I was one of the few students that wanted to be a producer because all my fellow students were screenwriters, directors, and I was one of the few, but it was a great experience to live among artists. So in a way, it gave me a lot of sensibility as a producer for, you know, in the future years, because, you know, living with directors or aspiring directors and aspiring writers, I could understand more where they were coming from, and I got much more sensibility towards that.
Luigi, but do you miss Los Angeles, the way they work, or you think that the real dream is Italy and not America?
No, I think the real dream now, thanks to our platforms, is the world more than ever. So I could still produce a great Italian movie or a great Italian series and become successful worldwide. It could be watched anywhere. It's happened already in the last few years, thanks to Sorrentino and other great directors or Italian producers. But to me, American movies or the industry in the States is definitely 100 times better than Italy. Italy is a small country in those terms, even though this year at the Oscars, we have some nominees, which is always great. But I think the Italian market is not doing too great for now. Thankfully, I hope in the future, because of the platforms and because contents are can become much more wide or can be of any sort, of any genre, because we don't have those limits anymore because of that, I think new Italian artists can be heard and seen much more than ever.
Well, why, by the time there is still up to around the world the American dream, there are some young talents who has the Italian dream. Last year, I met on February 9, on the Oscar night, an amazing young British fellow who happened to be on the Oscar night with one of the movies that got the awards. Check it out, what it is.
Say hi to Italy.
Hi, Italy.
Then we wait for you. You have to come soon.
Yes, yes.
We want you
yes,
to visit
I love
us.
Italy.
You love Italy?
I love Puglia. I love Italy.
Puglia?
Yes.
Oh, great!
Best holiday in the world.
Yeah, where in Puglia?
Ostuni.
Ostuni.
I like the south a lot.
There is also the animal. There is also
yes, the. Oh. I love it.
So go, yes. Boy, go.
Io sono particolarmente felice oggi di essere insieme a due bambini prodigio che, pur essendo dei grandi talenti nel cinema, mantengono quella semplicità, quell'umanità che si addice veramente ai bravi bambini ben educati da buone famiglie. Federico Jelapi, l'avete riconosciuto tutti, il protagonista di Pinocchio di Matteo Garrone, e poi questo nostro nuovo amico Roman Griffin Davis, protagonista di Jojo Rabbit. Federico, insomma, è una bella emozione conoscere questo tuo collega inglese.
Sì, è una bellissima emozione perché praticamente lui è bravissimo. E sì, spero di fare dei film con lui perché voglio divertirmi con lui.
Infatti, questo ragazzo mi ha sedotto sul red carpet degli Oscar quando stava salendo su al Dolby Theater per andare all'anteprima, per andare ad assistere alla notte degli Oscar. Guardate questo video. So I'm showing you your video. When you say I love Italy.
Say hi to Italy.
Hi, Italy.
Then we wait for you. You have to come soon.
Yes, yes.
We want you
yes,
to visit
I love
us.
Italy.
You love Italy?
I love Puglia. I love Italy.
Puglia?
Yes, love
Italy. Oh, great.
Best holiday in the world.
Yeah, where in Puglia?
Ostuni.
Ostuni.
I like the south a lot.
There is also the animal. There is also
yes,
the...
Oh. I love it.
So go, yes. Boy, go.
Italy, I love Ostuni, my best holiday. E ora Ischia, and now Ischia. Better Ischia or better Ostuni?
Ischia, definitely. Definitely, you kind of knocked Ostuni out of the park.
No, but just kidding. So, ritrovarsi qui in semplicità dopo che siamo visti su red carpet gli Oscar, to meet each other here since the Oscar night, how your life has changed? Quanto è cambiata la tua vita?
I mean, well, we went into lockdown straight afterwards, so I guess that has been a change. I guess it was, I kind of liked it because I didn't have to do much school, but changed, not really, but I guess I've kind of grown up a bit more.
Sei cresciuto, certo. Senti Federico, lui ci ha parlato appunto del momento difficile che abbiamo tutti vissuto per la quarantena che siamo costretti a vivere. Ecco, tu come hai vissuto questo momento particolare? Non sei andato a scuola, hai studiato attraverso il tuo computer?
Sì, ho studiato attraverso le piattaforme, cioè online, e sì. Ho studiato online e...
Insomma, com'è stata la tua vita in quarantena?
Beh, è stata un po' noiosa perché non potevi uscire, non potevi vederti con gli amici o questa roba qua. Quindi è stata un po' noiosa, però ora siamo pronti a ripartire. Certo. Soprattutto per il cinema.
Certo, per il cinema. E tu, insomma, hai papà che è un autore della fotografia, la mamma è una regista. Tu questo talento innato, proprio sei nato e cresci nel cinema. You have a great father, cinematographer. You have an amazing mother, director. You are an actor. You're born in cinema, and your future is in cinema, no?
I hope so. I'm really grateful to be able to, to have been born into a family that support the film industry. So yeah, yeah.
Bene. Senti, Federico, tu hai invece iniziato proprio piccolissimo con Checco Zalone, poi sei diventato protagonista di questo film di Matteo Garrone, che un po' ovunque ancora deve essere proposto, perché la quarantena, la pandemia ha costretto ha ritardato tantissime uscite. Insomma, Pinocchio ha cambiato la tua vita.
Sì, sì, perché comunque con Pinocchio ora posso avere più, magari più occasioni, non lo so, che qualcuno, qualche altro regista mi prenda, perché magari, cioè, pensano che fare il prostetico ogni mattina non sia una cosa, cioè, che è facile, capito? Spero comunque che mi prendino altri molti bravi registi, come sempre, come Matteo. Questa gente qua, sì.
Roman, tu che cosa vuoi fare da grande? What do you want to be when you are become an old boy?
I hope I'm still an actor, and I hope that I'm better at painting as well.
Ah, but, also, yeah. Anche pittore. Prima mi hai colpito perché hai detto voglio anche essere una brava persona. You touched me before because you said that I want to be a good man.
Yes, yes. I guess. If I do have children, I guess I want to be a good parent as well.
Yeah.
And I guess a good person all round. Yeah.
E tu che vuoi fare da grande?
Io l'attore, e perché è una cosa che mi ha colpito sin da quando ero piccolo, quando ero alto così.
Sì.
Che mi arrivava la coscia. e sì, è una cosa che ho sempre voluto fare. E pure io sì, vorrei avere dei figli. E sì, magari farli diventare sempre attori, oppure quello che vogliono loro, però sai com'è.
Ti piace molto questo mestiere, eh? Ti è divertito conoscere Roman?
Moltissimo, perché io prima Roman tipo non lo conoscevo, no? Però comunque mi sta molto simpatico, è proprio una brava persona.
He says that you are a good boy and he likes you so much, very sympathetic. Lo stesso dice di te. E Roman, è divertente essere qui, ti piace Ischia? Ti piace qualcosa? Ti piace l'Italia? What do you like of Ischia? What do you like of Italy?
The food's amazing. I've never had such good food in my life. The water's so clear that you could see the bottom. And the hotel I'm staying at is great. So it's all around an amazing place.
Bene, allora salutate il pubblico, cosa gli dite? Buona estate, felice estate, happy summer!
Buona estate e in inglese happy summer a tutti, cioè baci da Ischia.
What do you want to say? Happy summer to everybody?
Happy summer, hope you're all doing well and thank you Ischia.
Bello. Ok, Eugenio, facciamo una foto un secondo.
Ischia from last year, but here we see the magic of the Ischia Global Fest. This year it'll be the April 18th to the 25th.
July.
July. where are we? We're now in April. It's July 18th to the 25th. And it's a magical place to be. The Hotel Regina Isabella has a lagoon. The screen for the cinema is right there at the lagoon. Every evening there's music, there's culture. And there's also collaboration with music into the late hours. I've seen great improvised concerts at midnight, 1, 2 in the morning, there at the Hotel Regina Isabella. A little bit of jazz once in a while. But here we see Ben Kingsley with Pascal. And it's certainly a magical time where artists come together. It's more like a fellowship, more like a club, really, with all the artists that come. And they come back because it's not just a place to promote a film, but a place to gather with other filmmakers and other artists, other musicians, to just spend some time together. And everybody tends to relax, and everybody lets themselves just breathe for a moment. And for an artist, it's important to breathe, and also to get into the sea, and to relax, and to enjoy good food there in Ischia. And this is what happens. It's really a magical event that's been created here. The 19th event will be coming up this summer, so coming up to 20 years old. But here we see concerts happening, Volo, these young men who have now grown young adults, but they were there as one of their premier concerts was there at the Ischia Global Fest.
So here is Giancarlo with Carlo Verdone, who's actually doing, is writing and is directing this series for Amazon that Luigi De Laurentiis was talking about. Luigi, so what is for you the key of the success of this event in Ischia, the global festival?
I think you're on mute, Luigi. We hear you.
Did you?
And watch movies at night on the water, and I think that's spectacular for anyone, somebody who's Italian, somebody who comes from abroad. I mean, it's an amazing spectacle. And then you're always able to bring a lot of guests, a lot of music, a lot of, you have all the ingredients that make a festival fun and less institutionalized and more about people, actors, directors, artists that find each other together and have a casual time. And I think that makes it really great.
Giancarlo, it's Giancarlo Carriero, the Regina Isabella Hotel and Spa owner, and also well as president of the Campania's Hotel Owners. So it's a very surprising for me, the way the people that doesn't know Ischia approach it for the first time, as we saw the young Roman Griffin Davis, the leading star of Jojo Rabbit last year, they don't know about it because they just know the most popular Capri, and then they become kidnapped by Ischia Charming. And also, it's all about the public relation, because through the festival, to the global festival, and also recently the family show has been starting a good work with the other beautiful hotel, one of the other beautiful hotel of Ischia, the Mezzatorre, and they became a big deal for the American people. So what is that makes for you Ischia different and surprise the audience, the people, the talents, the journalists, when they first arrive, they don't know, and then they get away very sad because they're leaving?
I think that maybe it's a mystery. Maybe it's the void of the volcanic region of the island that makes something, some special energy to the people. That, of course, I'm kidding. I think that the nature is wonderful, all these kind of things, but the real special thing of the island of Ischia is that is an authentic place. It's a place where people still behave like they have always done during the centuries, and they are natural. They welcome tourists because this is the way they are done, and so this authenticity is what tourists like most. This is my opinion.
So, Gianluca, you have chosen Gianluca Isaia. You have chosen Capri as your second residence, maybe first residence. But you are always still a big lover of Ischia. What is for you the difference between the two islands, Capri and Ischia? Microphone.
Okay. So I love Capri as you know really well, but I have so many great memories in Ischia since I was very young until the last 15 years, and I have a special memory of the Regina Isabella. And I have Regina Isabella in the bottom of my heart because maybe Giancarlo Carriero remembers my parents. And my father and mother were going there every summer. And they were not even calling Regina Isabella Hotel, but every time they were coming there, they were telling me, we are going to paradise for a couple of weeks. So every time I come there, you know, I feel, you know, this memory in, and I feel my heart so full of love. So I really hope to come back soon this next summer to the Ischia.
So Aldo, you are another big ambassador of the Isle of Ischia. And I mean, you have made so much promotion in the Middle East. I mean, you are so aware of the touristic market in the Arabic Peninsula. But when it comes end of May until the end of September, there is no other country in the global imagination for holidays than Italy, and specifically Campania and Naples and Salerno Bays, no?
100%, Pascal. I mean, of course, in summertime, this is the best place to be. And coming back to Ischia, I think that the island is big enough or small enough to give you a different choice to spend your day or spend your night in the nature. And our bay and Salerno Bay is well known in the area where I used to live, actually Middle East, and is a destination which they really are willing to come. Capri as well, and of course Ischia and Capri and Salerno Bay, like Vietri, Positano, are our pearl. And we are like should be very proud to have those places, and makes our Italian to be special and tourist destination for all over the world. And this is actually, as I heard before, Italy is becoming a center of the world, and we are happy to hear that.
Yeah, Luigi, we have the American dream since we are born, but. The more we grow up, the most we love our own country. I mean, there is no better place to live than Italy, no? Your sound. Microphone.
Here we are. Yes, I mean, I totally agree. And it was great to hear from that very young actor how much he loved Italy and Ostuni. So that's a... very young generation that's going to be coming back to Italy much more often, thanks to the Ischia Film Festival, thanks to Puglia. So our country is able to attract so many people in the around the world because our lifestyle is unbeatable. I lived in the States, I lived in South America, I lived a little bit everywhere, but our country is the best. I'm sorry to say, but it really is.
Daniela, I want to ask you a question. That how does both Ischia and also just the Napoli Bay and the whole beauty of the sea, does that inspire you when you do your work in costume design?
I grew up in Naples, and I started my career there. And I'm so happy about that, because in that period, in the 80s, in Naples, there were a lot of people from other country. They arrived in Naples to have a workshop with us. And it was such an amazing moment in Naples in that moment, especially for arts and theater. And I had a lot of workshop with the Living Theater because they were in Naples a lot. They really loved Naples. They really loved Naples, and they were a lot of time there. And I think this is something that I brought in my career, my work, because to grow up in an amazing city, because I don't live always there, but I live around, but I Naples for me is a place of my heart, and I have in my and I brought with me all the things that I learned in Naples when I was young, and all the part of the historical heart and all the colors and the sun and the light, because this is something that I understand I have always with me and in my job.
Very good. So you take Naples around the world wherever you go, and it's always in your heart.
So I would suggest this, guys, that now we focus a little bit on the Laura Pausini case, because we have a big surprise. And considering in Ischia, Laura Pausini is the only one of that night, Magic, the Regina Isabella of 2007, that did still not get an Oscar, because we remember that night Alejandro González Iñárritu and Alfonso Cuarón, who actually was honored at the Regina Isabella on that night, but then afterward they got Oscars. Then we had other protagonists of the same year, Oliver Stone, Giuseppe Tornatore, Paul Haggis, Hilary Swank, and many other Oscar winners. That, I mean, already, so they have, everybody has an Oscar. The only one that has not an Oscar yet of that magic night, Regina Isabella, is this wonderful lady. Laura, to be associated with the legend of the legend, Miss Sophia Loren. Now you are really a prima donna, because you in a proper
not a
way.
Prima
because,
donna.
Yeah, we know in Italiano it has not the same meaning of Americano, but a first lady. You are definitely a first lady.
A first lady. Yes.
Now, as I told you before, it's another big responsibility, first of all, because the song is a step up from the message that Eduardo wanted to give to the movie, the whole movie. So we just wanted to be the voice of Sofia talking with Ibra, because Madame Rosa at this point of the movie is having a, not a chat, but something like very touching and special through the song, talking with Momo. And so this is touching, but especially thinking about giving a voice, singing to the icon, the only and the one and only Sofia is, I don't know what to say, because this still, so touching, so I'm so honored. And now that I'm here and I have to sing, I want to be as good as I can. I mean, the best of the best I can give to this song and to the movie and to Sofia and Eduardo and all the staff, Dejan, Nicolò, Ibra, to let us shine. Not me, but the movie, the message. We are a family with a message to give. And so it is a responsibility that I want to take, and I want to do it at my best. When I speak with Diane, and sometimes we're having interviews together, we always feel the same, like we built a family while you called us to be part of yours. So it is the same message that you want to give to the whole world through the movie. So it's so real that probably this is the meaning of what we are living today. People are receiving that.
Tu hai già detto che insomma sei emozionata, sei in quarantena, è un momento magico. Sono felice che anche la tua bambina stia vivendo questa forte emozione di una mamma così giovane, gagliarda, tutta Solarolo. Immagino il parroco di Solarolo che sta lì con le campane pronte. Mi ricordo che per la premiazione di Capri you started making like scongiuri. I wanted to bring a little cornicello for you today.
So, I have everything with me. I brought with me all the things from Italy that hopefully will give us luck. But yes, yes, of course, I have my bacchetta magica and also my Unipop, which is a cacca. Well, I have a wand, which is magical from, and good. Also a poo, a unicorn poo. But I want to show you. I want to show you the poo because it can be like. Horrible like to say, but very nice.
Laura, show us your poop.
That is a magical poop.
Big unicorn. That was a big unicorn.
It's a very colorful.
Big unicorn. You see that?
I need one. How do I get one of those?
Yes, let me send you one.
Ieri a Piazza del Popolo c'è stata una manifestazione alla quale hanno partecipato tutti. I lavoratori dello spettacolo, coloro che lavorano in silenzio, dai datori delle luci alle security, dai mixer piuttosto, tutta la gente che fa in modo che lo spettacolo vada avanti. Ecco, cosa vogliamo dire a queste persone che guardano al futuro con speranza di poter ritornare presto sulla scena?
Ma non solo con speranza, adesso bisogna cominciare a fare qualcosa di concreto per loro, perché per noi non si sta lavorando nella musica da troppo tempo, gli spettacoli sono considerati come non un bene di necessità emozionale primario e non trovo che sia giusto e la manifestazione di ieri, ancora una volta, perché non è la prima che fanno Bauli in piazza, è stata importante secondo me, è stata un grido al governo cercando di sensibilizzare ancora una volta le persone che devono decidere di riaprire, ovviamente in sicurezza, come tutti siamo da sempre pronti a rispettare, però adesso non si può più stare fermi. Molti di loro alcuni di loro, i ragazzi che c'erano ieri in piazza sono i ragazzi che lavorano insieme a me, c'erano anche alcuni miei colleghi, sono stata molto contenta di vederli lì. Io in quel momento ero in volo e mi sono collegata dall'aereo e ho cercato di mettere delle storie sul mio Instagram per far vedere che cosa stava succedendo e ovviamente sono con loro assolutamente al 100%.
Scott, now considering you are Mr. Forecast, Mr. Oscar for the Hollywood Reporter, we, as you know, we have some interest this year. Could you tell us what is your forecast for Laura Pausini and Diane Warren and Nicolai Iardi for the song You'll see scene.
But I will say, I think there is an excellent chance for Laura Pausini and Diane Warren. Diane is the most nominated person in the history of the Oscars, the most nominated woman to not have won yet. This is her 12th nomination. She's never won. But this year, the best original song category is very sort of evenly divided. There's no obvious front runner, no obvious favorite. And I think people by this point are now becoming clear about the fact that, first of all, the song is very good. It won the Golden Globe already. But additionally, they do realize it's like, how long are you going to make Diane wait? And she and Laura have a nice history together. And I think that it could go to any of those songs. But my personal hunch is that this may be the year for Diane, which would mean it's also the year for Laura. I hope that's the case.
Well, this was the opinion of an incredible gentleman that does the journalist, as the correspondent for the Hollywood Reporter, the Our columnist. And we have the honor to have with us today Laura Pausini father, Fabrizio Pausini, who actually is the one who made of Laura a legend, because he is a music singer, composer, and he created the little Laura and became the big Laura, eh?
Sì,
Però il merito è tutto suo, comunque.
Il merito tutto di Laura?
Sì.
Vabbè, insomma, papà gliel'ha insegnato...
Sì, però la voce era sua,
Ho capito, però ha avuto una bella educazione.
Allora mi prendo il merito tutto io.
No, anche la mamma.
No, ma va bene.
Diamo anche un po' ai genitori un po' di... Ti vedo molto...
Teso.
Sei teso?
Un pochettino sì.
Ma dai.
Un poco.
No.
Non è facile oggi proprio alla vigilia di questa manifestazione mondiale di Oscar, quindi mi sento... un po' emozionato.
Ma noi ti siamo infinitamente grato di essere venuto qui a trovarci.
No, grazie a voi dell'invito. Poi ho ritrovato l'amico Daniel qui, ci conosciamo da anni, mi ha fatto molto piacere.
Ecco Fabrizio, hai sentito il columnist dell'Hollywood Reporter che dà per favorita la canzone di Laura e Nicolò e soprattutto di Diane Warren? Primo, perché è una bellissima canzone. Secondo, perché non ci sono canzoni, diciamo, altrettanto belle e che hanno tutte le componenti per poter vincere. Terzo, perché la signora Diane Warren, una leggenda assoluta della musica, ha avuto ben 11 nomination. Questa è la dodicesima. Prima ne ha avute 11.
Sicuro?
Sicurissimo. Questa è la dodicesima nomination. Quindi, fino ad oggi ha avuto 11 nomination date a vuoto. Quest'anno è la dodicesima e... No.
Dobbiamo vincere.
Dobbiamo vincere,
speriamo,
No, ma senti, ma allora, mi vuoi spiegare meglio la storia del libro che tu hai letto mentre tua moglie era incinta? No, prima di che fosse incinta di Laura.
Allora, questo libro di un autore americano, io lessi sul settimanale Grazia all'epoca, sto parlando anni 70, 68, 69. Aveva tradotto in italiano tutto quello che... Guarda che sta storia è lunghissima, non posso stare qui.
Tranquillo, qui.
È molto lunga. E quindi ho comprato questo libro dove c'era scritto che seguendo le sue istruzioni, questo era per un figlio solo, si poteva decidere quale lavoro potevi indirizzare, in quale lavoro, quale... arte, qualsiasi cosa, solo per la prima volta, visto che quando ero giovane io, mio padre diceva sempre che dovevo fare quello che faceva lui, il lavoro suo e il suo desiderio, io ho fatto un altro lavoro. Allora io mi sono messo d'impegno, leggendo dalla prima all'ultima pagina, ho seguito tutte le istruzioni.
Hai capito?
Durante, insomma, non si può dire, però durante tutte le serie che si faceva. Quello, ecco, dovevo fare quello. È stata una fatica enorme, anche per mia moglie, perché mi diceva, ma cosa stai facendo? Cosa facciamo qua? Poi alla fine però, io non so, questo che avevo in testa, questa cosa qui, tutti questi premi, io li ho sognati tutti. Cioè, durante tutta questa gestazione era un giorno dovevo fare quello, ed è caduto puntualmente tutto. Questo sarebbe l'ultimo, gli altri sono andati bene tutti, speriamo che vada bene anche questo.
Ecco, c'è un amico che vive a Monte Carlo che si chiama Ezio Greggio, che è pronto a festeggiare Laura al suo Monte Carlo Film Festival a brevissimo, e sono certo che insomma sta lì anche lui con tutti gli amuleti, i cornicieli napoletani, quelle cose, no Ezio?
Assolutamente sì, confermo. Io sono un grande tifoso come tutti gli italiani e non solo di Laura, ma non solo. Devo dire che ho già pronto qui, aspetta che lo prendo, ce l'ho già qui pronto, eccolo qui, il Monte Carlo Film Festival ha già pronto il premio da consegnare a Laura Pausini, quindi io sono già pronto e nel momento in cui Laura... deciderà di venire, ovviamente dopo l'Oscar, io sono pronto e le consegnerò il premio che meritatamente riceverà con grandissimo piacere. La grande Laura, ma quanto sono felice, sono veramente felice di questa nomination meritata, poi vedere insieme il papà Ecco, e a fianco quel signore senza capelli che è il nonno, il nonno Pascal di Laura Pausini, mi fa molto piacere. E ho visto Dan McVicar, al quale mando un bacio, da tanto tempo che non lo vedevo. Ciao Dan, how are you?
Vengo io a prendere il premio.
Scusa, ma un premio per il papà? Che
no, no, no.
Fabrizio,
no, no, per il premio, no, no, ecco, ha preparato anche quello. Hai preparato anche quello.
Non essere il solito, ecco, spilorcio, per, almeno due premi, uno per il papà e uno per Laura. Scusa, eccoli.
A due addirittura.
Se c'è qualche bravo, bravo altro parente, io. Basta saperlo, poi io mi ho capito, sì, sì. Non c'è problema. Con grandissimo piacere.
Grazie.
Senti, Ezio, no, prima di tornare a Laura Pausini e alla superstizione di Laura Pausini, ci spieghi bene quali sono le date del Monte Carlo Film Festival e quali saranno, diciamo, a parte il premio a Fabrizio e Laura Pausini, prima Fabrizio e poi Laura Pausini. Certo. Quali saranno gli ospiti principali d'onore?
Guarda, allora, first of all, I have to speak in English. I've seen you have a lot
of
friends.
We have also other guests with us, Joe Mantegna, yes, Guy Native, and many others.
Just, just.
Yes, yes, let's speak English. So I'm very happy to announce that the 18th edition of the Monte Carlo Film Festival will take place here in Monte Carlo from May 31 to June the 5th, and the great news is that we will do it live. We have a real audience coming on stage at the Grimaldi Forum, and that's a great news. It's great news for all the people that are working in this kind of business, and also because, you know, when you project a movie, it's wonderful to have people on stage. Of course, we will have all the safety rules that are very important. That means we have control of the temperature at the entrance. We have all the people that they must have done the test, and they have to wear masks during the projection. We will have distances from one sitter to the other. So that's very important, but it's great to know that we have a real audience on stage to see the movies. And same thing will be at the last night, that will be the Saturday the 5th, when we deliver the award. We will have real audience. We have the TV, my channel that does the TV show for that we go on the air a few days later. So that's a great news for us, you know, to do a festival as we did in the last October with real audience and live. I think it's a great news. And the great, great news is that the president of the jury this year will be Raul Bova, that is very well known also in the United States, not only in Italy, in many countries. And we are happy to announce that Raul will be the new president. Last year we had Nick Vallelonga. 2 years ago we had Emir Kusturica, and before Claude Lelouch and John Landis and Michael Radford. So we have a great tradition about a great president. And in particular, I'm very happy because also this year, think, Pascal, that we had more than 100 movies. They would like to show up in our festival, and we have to choose only more or less 20 movies at the end. And that movies that will come from United States, Spain, Germany, France, South America, Italy, of course. And very soon we will deliver the title and all the members of the jury and the guests. For sure we will have a great number of guests and a great jury, as in our tradition.
The most successful Italian producer of comedy with us, and is very offended with you because although he sent you once your friend Checco Zalone, you never honored Pietro Valsecchi as the best producer of the year, as he deserved, because he's the most successful successful producer, Italian producer ever. Let me finish. One second, Pascal. Maestro, please. One Pascal. Second.
Yeah. Pietro Valsecchi is so old that he doesn't remember that he received this award, this wonderful award. It was received from Pietro Valsecchi in the same moment we delivered one to Checco Zalone, but I understand, you know, I understand that Pietro he has many things in his brain, and he's very old, he's 95 now, so I think probably he doesn't remember, but who cares? He has, no. He had already the award.
So, Pietro, it's true, did he give you the award?
I don't see Pietro, where is Pietro?
Pietro is there.
Show up.
Il microfono, Pietro, attiva.
Non lo vedo, non vedo Pietro, he's non there. Lo sento. He's a ghost.
Golden Gate Bridge.
Pietro. Niente, mandaci un telegramma, Pietro, poi lo leggiamo con comodo, dai, tanto è uguale.
Unmute.
Attivare il microfono.
Ok,
ci siamo?
Perfetto, sì.
Eccolo, ecco, adesso lo vedo.
Come state?
Bene. Ma sei all'aperto, c'è il ciuffo che fa così, sei all'aperto.
Come mai? Non lo so. Chi mi fa volare il ciuffo? Qualcuno mi fa
però
volare
si capisce dal ponte che hai dietro, si capisce benissimo che sei a Bassano del Grappa, giusto?
No, sono... Ma come cazzo, chi mi ha messo dietro questo... Vabbè.
È bellissimo.
Mi ha messo
poi
dietro un ponte.
C'è un ponte e c'è... O sei dal dentista che ti sta sistemando il ponte, oppure vedo un vento della Madonna in testa. Che
non so, il cazzo...
Pietro, sorry, we have also American guest with us, esatto. Maestro... Ezio, we have Maestro Joe Mantegna. As you can see. And we have also the amazing... Oscar-winning director Guy Nativ, Israeli director living in Los Angeles, Pietro Valsecchi. So did he seriously honored you with an award? Because Ezio Greggio keep using the same awards for the guests. So he gives, then he gets back. You know. So did he really present you the award?
No, that's Pascal that does this, because nighttime before to do the delivering of the awards. Pascal builds every copy of the awards in plastic. He does it with Lego, you know, the plastic stuff. He put it together and then he delivered. And so, but that's okay. Who cares? He's from Naples, so we know it.
Bene. Allora, cosa vuoi che vi racconto?
Pietro, Pascal, ti ha mai effettivamente premiato il buon Ezio Greggio a Monte Carlo?
Sì, certo. Come no? Un sacco di volte. Diciamo che lui è molto generoso nei nostri confronti. È stato uno dei primi a chiamarci con Zalone su a Monte Carlo. Aveva già capito l'importanza di questo grande comico italiano.
Infatti, è di questo grande produttore che ha saputo e ha intuito che Checco aveva grandi doti.
Sì, è vero. Comunque, abbiamo fatto un remake in questo momento a Parigi del film di Zalone. Abbiamo covato, l'abbiamo fatto in questo momento a Parigi con Gérard Commandeur. Uscirà a Natale, un film da 14 milioni di euro, una grande attesa, ho visto il film, molto molto divertente. Ne abbiamo fatto un altro in Spagna che è andato molto bene. Insomma, Zalone è un po' come un maiale, non si butta niente.
Ma Zalone, diciamo che è l'uovo dalla gallina d'oro, cioè la gallina dalle uova d'oro, perché comunque è veramente un geniaccio. Più i suoi film si vedono una volta al mese e non stancano mai.
Pascal, sorry, you told me that he's with us, Joe Mantegna is with us. I want to see Joe Mantegna and to talk to him because I love him and I want to give him a big kiss. Because you are so great and I love you a lot. So I don't care about Pietro, I don't care about Pascal.
I don't care.
No, stay. We have to do a movie produced from Pietro Valsecchi. And the two lead actors will be Joe Mantegna, Ezio Greggio, that's me, and a small role for Dan McVicar, maybe. We have to see.
Directed by Guy Nativ and distributed by Minerva Pictures. And maybe...
Yes, of course.
And maybe the supervising of the script by Luca Sommi, who's actually enjoying the Parma area. Joe, how is the feeling in Los Angeles one day before the Oscar?
Oh, it's good. It's you know, it's going to be a little different, but now they're going to be at the train station, which is a very beautiful place. I remember when we did the movie Bugsy years ago, we shot there because it dates back, you know, to the 30s. And so it's it'll be different, but it'll be very nice. There's a lot of excitement. And, you know, the Oscar, it's Hollywood. I mean, this is Hollywood. So this is a big day. Tomorrow will be a big day.
It doesn't seem that there is a lot of excitement because we see the street of downtown LA. We see the street of Wilshire, just where the Museum of the Academy is. We see Hollywood as well. And there is not so much enthusiasm around, not many people walking in the street. It's something very, very low key in order to don't create a lot of emphasizing because the situation is complicated, not only in Italy, but all over the world.
Of course. So it'll be different, of course. But I think you have to make, you know, you have to make lemonade with the lemons. So, I mean, I think the fact they're going to the train station will make it visually different for the public, people to who are going to be watching it all over the world. So it, they're doing the best they can. And the main thing is they're able to do it. Movies were made, movies will be watched, and the business will continue and go on. And hopefully next year we'll have a little closer to normal, you know, hopefully.
Guy Native, you won an Oscar 4 years ago. And I mean, you were produced by our Ischia Global president, Trudy Styler. And so the following summer, she brought you to Ischia. So what is the feeling for an Oscar nominated director, actor, music composer, whatever, the day before the Oscar?
First of all, buongiorno, amici. It's good to be here. And I just, Pascal, I wanted to give you a big shout out, you know, because you brought us up to the Oscar with Skin the Short and Skin the Feature, and you are a big supporter for independent cinema all over the world. So thank you again from all the independent directors all over the world, not only in Hollywood. But you're right. This, the atmosphere right now in you know, Hollywood is kind of like very low key. You don't have those parties and all this kind of excitement that we used to know before the Oscar. But you know, in 5 minutes, I will have the Israeli nominee for the best short film, White Eye, coming here. So we'll have a little celebration. The Israeli delegation is coming here. So it would be nice for him also to say hi to you guys and to express his feelings before the before Sunday. But yeah, for us, it was insane because, you know, in 2019, we just jumped from party to party to party, and it was like insane. It was back to back, you know, the PR kind of a machine that you have to, we had a war room here in our house. And we needed to just make screenings, face-to-face screenings, that was part of the game. And Trudy Styler, obviously, and Sting helped us a lot, and Fox Searchlight came on board at some point. So we are very grateful for Sting and Trudy for making this happen, this the short and the feature, and they became a partner for life for us.
Yes, I just read that you are up for a new movie starring Helen Mirren, where she's acting as a Golda Meir.
Yes, so Helen Mirren will play Golda Meir in a biopic that we're making. It's very exciting. She's a legend. And it's about Golda Meir, 10 days in the war, in the bunker, really the last days of her lives. It's a kind of a requiem for a leader. Not controlling her commanders, and basically on the verge of a nervous breakdown. So it's a very intense movie. Kind of everything is like inside the trenches of the war, and all the war scenes that you actually see through her cigarette smoke. So it's in her head. It never cuts to any kind of a war scene outside. So it's basically like Das Boot or the downfall of Hitler. So it's one location, it's very exciting, and Helen will be perfect.
So Luca Sommi, Golda Meir, a personality of the international politics, is having a biopic by Guy Native. Do you have a special memory of Golda Meir, Luca?
Microphone, Luca.
Luca,
Pascal. Which one?
Yes.
Ecco Luca.
There you go.
Can you hear me? Ah, Dante, ma devi accendere il microfono, Luca. The microphone.
Pascal, ma si vede dove sono io?
Luca, non ti sento bene, dimmi.
You can hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Hello to my friend, American friend, Italian friend. I wrote a book on Dante Alighieri. Not on Dante Alighieri, but on Divina Commedia. Because if tonight Laura is going to win, it's because he's Italian, she's Italian. And Italy is the country of Dante Alighieri. This year is 700 years from the death of Dante Alighieri. So it's so important to remember him because he wrote the poem most important in the history of literature of the world. And Dante speaks to us again after 7 centuries. And Dante tell us what is our life. And through his incredible trip through hell to purgatory to paradise, he teach us that we have to dream every day, because it's a trip of a man through overworldly place that is important, because he teach us that we have to walk. We have to walk every day, and we don't have to have fear about the future. And what I have to do? Tell me, Pascal.
Asking, considering Guy Native is shooting a movie about a biopic about Golda Meir, do you have any special thought about this incredible personality of the politics of the past?
Yes, it's one of the most important personality. It's a name that is not only a name, but is something like an iconic dream. It's it means she's a woman that became a dream. What I have to say is this: she's a dream. She's a really dream. And you know, when we talk about dream, we talk about something that we can touch. We can touch, but the dream is the only way to live. Dante Alighieri teach us that a man can get a trip throughout soul, throughout a dead land, and learning what is the mystery of life. You have to know that I think that a lot of the cinema, the history of cinema, get a lot from Dante Alighieri, because he's more than Harry Potter, he's more than Jurassic Park, he's more amazing, he's most incredible. And when you talk about cinema, you talk about something that put your soul in a dream. And Dante Alighieri walk into the hell. He met a lot of person, a lot of satanic animals. He met Socrates, Maomet, Ulisse, Paolo e Francesca, he met Lucifero, and he have done this trip with who? With a poet, a classic poet, Virgilio, his teacher, that was die 13th century before him. And after that, when he arrived to paradise, with who? With Beatrice, his love. So it's a poem that talk about dreams, about love, and about our life, 7 centuries after it was wrote. So you can't you imagine what is the Divina Commedia. You can't remember from the school how much is important these poems. When he arrived in paradise, he met Jesus Cristo and he met Maria and he see God. And he understand, he know the mystery of Christianity, the reincarnation. So, Divina Commedia is a big dream. It's a big dream of a poet that lived 70 centuries ago. But he have to teach us a lot, a lot. And I think that the cinema, a movie, each movie in the world see to a dream, like Dante Alighieri.
So, Joe Mantegna, I suppose you are very sorry that you could not join Pupi Avati for the upcoming movie that he asked you to do about Dante Alighieri and his relationship with Boccaccio, because you are busy in another job with for a previous contract.
Yes, I hope, you know, and as you know, I have many relatives in Italy as well. So just the idea of being able to go to Italy to make a movie about Dante, to visit with my family, it was very heartbreaking for me. But, you know, hopefully, you know, I've been very fortunate in my life. I've made maybe 4 or 5 movies in Italy. I hope to come again sometime soon. And, you know, I can't complain. I've had a very good life. I mean, I've been very blessed, and it's just nice to be in an event like this, to share it with all you all, and it will go on. I mean, we've gone through a tough year, more than a year now, but things are getting better, and I'm glad to see that Italian cinema is also flourishing, coming back. It seems like, you know, it seems like there was a period when it was in flux, and it seems like now there's such a great desire and interest in continuing the great tradition of Italian cinema.
So, Ezio Greggio, besides being the man who created and who's running the Monte Carlo Film Festival, you are also an amazing actor. So tell Joe Mantegna, what did he lose not working with Pupi Avati, considering you've been working with Pupi Avati on the movie Giovanna's Father? That actually,
yes,
you owe me because you got the job at Capri Hollywood Festival.
Bullshit, but that's okay. But no, it's true. It's true. We did a meeting. We did a meeting with Pupi there. Yes, that's true. No, I want to tell Joe this. I did like 40 comedies in Italy.
You say there's a bullshit?
As an actor, I'm a comedian.
Excuse me, it's a great job.
Yeah.
You say that it was a bullshit. It's not true that you got a job in Capri?
No. Yes, it's true. Also because okay. You are there. If you are not there, I will say no. But you are there, I will say yes, of course. No, we met in Capri thanks to Pascal. I met Pupi. I knew already Pupi there. But when we met, we started to talk about this project. And what I want to tell to Joe is the fact that as a comedian, I did 40 movies, 45 movies. And I had a word, but you know, a word connected with good income of the movies on theaters. Then I did this dramatic role, really dramatic role. I was a fascist in this movie at the end of the Second War. Very touching movie, very, very different role. And so with this movie, I had so many awards, Joe, that I had to buy a new house only to put all the awards that I got because I did a dramatic role. And probably you know that for us, it's more difficult for an actor to be funny than to be dramatic. This is my opinion, absolutely. I came on the set, I did my role, and a role that I knew very well because my father was involved in the Second War. He was in a concentration camp for almost 3 years. So I knew exactly, you know, the feeling of an historical moment like that one. But anyway, Pupi is a great director, and he did a great movie.
we had like 15 minutes of applause when we did the premiere at the Venice Film Festival. And then I won any kind of award that in Italy was available. And I love Pupi. And when you will have another chance, please work with Pupi, because you are so wonderful, and Pupi too. So I can imagine the two of you together will be a great movie for sure.
This was this was really something that Pupi was looking for. But I mean, unfortunately, Joe had the previous commitment, and with this pandemic, he could not give up to the other job.
Yes.
But Pupi Avati is one of these Italian masters that always are being together with us in Los Angeles for the annual Film and Music and Fashion and Art Festival. And the yes. Italian Masters is the section, one of the sections that this year we are promoting on the platforms thanks to the support of Minerva Pictures, who's president and CEO Gianluca Curti is with us. Now Gianluca Curti is also the one who is creating an amazing platform, Movie Italy, that shortly will be available all over the world in order to show all the Italian movies' major offer, including both classic movies, and I remember this section we did here at Los Angeles, Italia, together with Minerva and Intesa San Paolo, and then modern movies, as Gianluca is currently working producer and a very successful producer. So Gianluca, when the platform Movie Italy will be available?
Hello, Scott. Hello, everybody. We will start working with this from September, and we start at the very beginning from the USA and Canada, where we should have, in theory, more than 7 million people that might be interested in our ESVO platform. But our main goal is, above all, to get as many people as possible around a place where you can find all the Italian movies, all Italian cinemas that have been made in the last 8 years. So we will go from Fellini to Bertolucci, from the Italian giallos and the so-called spaghetti western, to the very big names that still nowadays are making great the Italian cinema all over the world. So it's something which is just in the middle between an economic way of making things happen and our heritage, as you said, our amazing heritage, because all Italian masters and producers and actors have been doing great things in the last decades. So it's something that nobody did before us, and I'm very happy that with a fantastic team, we are going to make this happen. But Pascal, if I can, I would like to say hello to some friends that I see here. Ezio, I'm still waiting for your script.
Yes, that's true.
Sooner or later, you will send it to me. But in the meantime, I would like to say hello
to Massimiliano Bruno. We are close to finish. The last touch.
I would like to say hello to Massimiliano Bruno, because next year, hopefully, I will produce a movie directed by Marco Martani that has been written by Massimiliano Bruno and Marco Martani as well. So I see a bunch of friends there, and it's very nice to have you here. And I'm also the younger brother of Pascal, because I am bold, Pelado as well, but he's much older than I am.
Oh, yes.
For sure. Yes. I am 95 currently. I might go for 96. Soon. So,
Ciao Daniel.
You mentioned Massimiliano Bruno, who is actually one of the Italian master of comedy, and he is now driving because he is always working. He's unstoppable. Although he has one movie on the table waiting to be brought released theatrical, is already shooting one more movie. Hey, Massimiliano, nothing can stop your creativity.
Well, because I have to pay my new house, and so I have to work. I'm joking. We are working to the new movie. And I stay in Santa Severa, that is a wonderful castle near Rome. And our movie showed the Italian situation in 1943 after the 8th of September. We talk about the Nazis, the war, the Second World War, and it's, ladies and gentlemen, a comedy. We talk about war, maybe with a little smile, but we have very important Italian actors like Marco Giallini, Gianmarco Tognazzi, that is the son of Ugo Tognazzi, very important Italian actor, and Giampaolo Morelli, and Edoardo Leo, and others, wonderful actors and actresses like Carolina Crescentini and Ilenia Pastorelli and Giulia Bevilacqua. So it's amazing for me work in this period. I hope that next year we can enjoy in cinemas to stay together and see the new movies of Italian productions.
Thank you, Massimiliano. So talking about classic but also about modern stuff, we have also Giuseppe Pedersoli, who actually is a producer. He recently produced a movie that is a fun, is a grandfather double-checking the possibility to make a movie with Federico Fellini than he did, and he explained the truth of the truth reason of the La Dolce Vita. And Giuseppe, of course, you all know as being also the Bud Spencer's son, one of the iconic, most iconic Italian actor ever. So Giuseppe, you are always in between classic and modern stuff as Gianluca Curti is.
Ciao Pascal, ciao Gianluca and everybody. Yes, and we were also very happy today to know that we were given the best international documentary prize in New York Independent Film Festival. So, and with Gianluca, we will cooperate also in the distribution of this documentary, because Gianluca saw it in Venice when we showed it in the festival, and hopefully we'll be able to put it on his platform soon. Yes, my family goes for the third decade, for the third generation in cinema. Of course, the previous ones were much more important than me. My grandfather, Giuseppe Amato, produced the most important films in the neorealism, realizing the first direction of Vittorio De Sica and so many other important films. And La Dolce Vita was definitely the most, the challenge of his life. We were able to find incredible documents that tell the story of La Dolce Vita directly with the voices of the protagonists, Federico Fellini, Giuseppe Amato, Angelo Rizzoli, that were exchanging every day letters, telegrams, contracts, budgets that tell the everyday story of the production of La Dolce Vita. Everybody knows that it's been a great success, but nobody, not many people know the real background of that project that nobody wanted to produce. So it was for me a honor to be able to put together all these informations into a documentary, and we are very happy about the results.
Fantastico.
To honor Giuseppe for this documentary in Monte Carlo or not? I mean, don't be cheap. You need to honor Giuseppe. And did you have?
I pay to have a documentary so wonderful like this one. I'm not like
you. Pay how much? Because I have Avvocato della Ragione with us. Maybe we can make a contract right away.
$5 as the anticipation, and then I will sit directly with him. But you remember, Bud came at our festival.
Sure.
It was a great standing ovation, that one of the longest standing ovation we had on theater, with more than 2,000 people. and he was so happy to be there. He told us a lot of stories about his career, and it's one of the most touching and happiest remember I had and I have of his participation in our festival. Fantastic, bud.
I know very well. And thank you, Ezio. Thank you, Pascal. And thank you, Gianluca, because all of you are doing a great job to promote the Italian cinemas in the world. So this is fantastic, especially grazie. In a moment like this.
Yes, yes, yes. We do our best, you know. Comedies are so important. I think it's the genre most loved from audience. And my festival, we start May 31 till June the 5th. And it's the 18th edition we are going to do. So it's a long story. When we started, there was no big festival open to have comedies in their program. Now comedies are everywhere, and they won also Academy Awards. So I think we did really a great pushing with the help of Mario Monicelli, that with me started this wonderful festival, and is always in our heart. And in our memory. So as you say, comedies are very important, and we have to continue to promote all comedies, not only the Italian one. I mean, all the comedies in the world are great.
But I'm a little witness, Pascal, if I can.
Yes.
One year ago, an actor from a movie which I produced, it was Ladri Gardellini, the actor was Nando Paone, got an award there, and
yes.
Ezio gave it to this prize to him, so I can tell you as a witness that he gets these prizes and these awards for real, the real one. So it's very generous, and it was probably, you know, also with a kind of golden stuff around the award. So
tell it.
It was very precious. This is for real.
Pascal, I'm sorry, but I have to leave because I have a very
just
important
want to ask you
here in Monte Carlo. I have
two questions.
My friend,
Ezio,
so he's waiting
Ezio.
For me. He's calling 30
times. Yeah,
no.
Okay, one question. Ezio, did you invite Massimiliano Bruno for honoring him?
I'm very happy to invite him, but I want to know how much he eat, because, you know, our festival is a small one. I've seen that Massimiliano is a great guy, so I am a little bit afraid that the cost...
I come, Ezio.
Allora, deal, is done. I don't know where I'm going now with the car. Turn.
Do you have a private jet prepared for Maestro Joe Mantegna? It just flies
yes,
private.
Yes, absolutely. So the private jet will be paid, Joe, from Pascal Bicedomi, because he does a rich festival. My small one in a small village in the south of France called Monte Carlo.
Well, don't tell to Prince Albert that it's a small village, Monte Carlo, because, you know, he's going to kick you out from there. thank you so much, Ezio.
I love everybody. First,
ciao, Ezio.
I love Joe Mantegna, Massimiliano.
No, but the date, where are the date of the festival? And you go.
Thank you very much. A big kiss
the
to everybody.
The date of the festival.
Pascal
when is
Smaller.
The,
Pascal Smaller.
When is when is the festival?
And Joe, I will do my best to have you in my festival or in this edition next, anytime, because when you will come, you will be the president of the festival, and I will give you the legend award, because you are a legend for us here.
Grazie.
In Italy,
Ezio,
Europe, in
when
the
is
world.
The festival?
Grazie.
Sorry?
When is the festival? Fabrizio Pausini wants it. He wants to take a note because you
Fabrizio
invited him.
Has to come with his daughter. They will come for sure. It's May 31. The night of the award will be June the 5th, Sabato 5 giugno. Ti aspetto, Fabrizio, con grande piacere. And you will sing, not your daughter, you will sing something.
Tu devi cantare,
Fabrizio, devi cantare tu, non tua figlia.
Va bene.
Okay. Grazie Ezio, grazie mille.
Benissimo,
grazie a tutti, grazie.
Ciao.
Hello everybody.
Joe, we have been talking about the classic and the modern. So what do you know of the modern Italian cinema?
You talking to me?
Yes.
Oh yeah. Well, I mean, what's interesting is that it's become, especially among my friends here in America, a lot of people are discovering, you know, not just what's going on now, but there's almost been like a rediscovery of Italian cinema, maybe because of the pandemic, maybe because of the COVID. People are looking beyond, you know, they're starting to look into material that has already been done. And so I have so many friends who come up to me and said, oh, have you seen these, you know, and they'll talk about these, you know, classic Italian cinema, but then they'll also talk about things that are, you know, it's causing their interest in what's going on now, especially some of the series that were done. You know, so I just think there's been somewhat of a resurgence of an interest in Italian cinema. And I think part of it is because of the fact that the industry has had to slow down over this period of time and has focused attention out of Hollywood and looked at other places. And I think even if you look at, even well, the Academy Awards are tomorrow, I think it's a reflection of it, because so much of the interest is coming from films. There's in a way more interest coming up for films and actors and producers and directors from outside of our country, outside of the United States, which is, I think, is a good thing. And I think Italian cinema, it will be one of the ones that will benefit from that as well. And I know I certainly look forward to a time when I could come back to Italy and work there. And it's just such a joy for me. It's part of my heritage, you know, to be able to participate in that.
So there are figures in our business who are very iconic. And the figure of the lawyer in Los Angeles is very important. In Italy, we just don't pay enough attention to the job that the lawyer does in cinema. Well, this gentleman here, who's very popular in Hollywood, is one of the most important bridge between American and Italian cinema. Although, I mean, I want to say Italian and global cinema. Is this Bruno Della Ragione, who actually was here before. I was talking about him, but then he disappeared. And I don't know, Bruno, are you there? Bruno, ci sei? No, non si sente. There is no microphone. Okay, there Bruno, accendi il microfono. Are you there?
Non funziona. The microphone,
you
Bruno.
Need to devi accendere il microfono, Bruno.
Eccomi, mi senti?
Oh, okay. So I was saying that you are a legend in your business.
You are very kind, but it's not true.
No?
I'm so young to be a legend.
No, no, Bruno Della Ragione, non Massimiliano Bruno. Ehi, relax.
Ah. Massimiliano Bruno is my lawyer in Los Angeles.
Ciao.
Bruno, I chose the wrong Bruno.
Bruno, ci sei?
Pascal, now?
Yes, yes, yes.
Good morning to everybody.
But you have Hello? A terrible connection. Can you talk?
Yeah. Bad connection, unfortunately.
But I'm saying that you make an amazing job for bridging Italy to America.
Yeah. I don't hear you at all. Listen, I'll try to change device. Maybe I can.
We can hear you now. You can make your statement now, Bruno. So
yeah, but
so many movies. So many co-production are done thanks to your job. Is it easier today or before was easier?
During my life. Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. How many co-productions?
Yes.
At least 100, maybe.
So this is the reason you are a legend, because you created so yes, you created so much work.
Listen, Pascal, unfortunately the audio is horrible, is a very bad connection for me. Then it's very complicated. May I have to change the device?
But we hear you very well.
Because my phone doesn't work. I don't hear you at all.
Okay. So Gianluca Guzzo actually is the CEO of My Movies, one of the platforms we are using for this event, who's actually done between the virtual with the My Movies and eventive.org, an American platform, and the Chinese theater. So, Gianluca, what is the situation like in terms of awareness of this new world, which is the virtual cinema?
Yes, hello, hi everybody. And well, I think is a magic, the feeling we can feel here. And because what we are trying to do with even if it is a streaming platform, what we are trying to do is to give to our audience to feel like in real cinema, you know, in real festival. And this is our challenge. This is our goal, basically. And with this festival this time, I think we really reach that kind of mood, that kind of a feeling. The users who are following in Italy and also in LA are many. Is very, very interesting, because we have a very interesting and independent shorts, and our audience are following everything with very, very high interest. That's very interesting for us. Is interesting for our job. As you said before, yes, it's very interesting what we are discovering this year. It's 1 year after the pandemic things, after the COVID, and yes, we discovered that also the independent movies have a market also in internet, also in streaming. That's what we discovered in Italy, in our experience, and also in this case with experience with you, so also in USA, in Los Angeles, and that's which could change a lot in terms of markets, and especially for independent movies that, you know, we care a lot.
Thank you so much, Gianluca. I think that the work we started in Capri Hollywood together, it's simply amazing. And I always say that since Capri Hollywood 2020, we are going to always to increase our partnership in all the festival I care, like Los Angeles, like ISCA in the summer. So always we will have two festival, one virtual and one physical, because to have a physical event in the town where you organize the festival is important, it's amazing. But then it's also very important to communicate to a global market. So there is an amazing musician with us, Laura Pausini, colleague, even because he also won Sanremo, as Laura did. And I want to thank you for joining us here tonight, Marco Masini. Marco, welcome to Los Angeles, Italia. I hope next year you're going to be with us in Los Angeles to showcase, as in the past we have had as our special guest Zucchero, Francesco De Gregori, Ron, and many, many other of your colleagues. So how does it feel to know that your friend Laura Pausini is running for an Oscar, and tomorrow is having the most important career moment ever?
Who's it, Pascal? I have to leave only because it's here. It's 11:30, and I have to.
Thank you so much, Joe. We love you. Thank you so much.
I just want to thank you. My best to everyone. Tanti saluti, tutti amici in Italia.
We love you, Joe. We hope to have you in Ischia in July.
Buon lavoro.
I hope so. Thank you. Ciao, ciao.
Marco.
Ciao. Hey, Joe.
Marco, hai sentito la mia domanda? Devi accendere il microfono, Marco. Ci sei, Marco? Perfetto.
You listen me?
Yeah, now I have you.
Yes?
Yes.
Okay.
So what is your feeling for Laura in most important day for tomorrow?
Yes. I'm very happy. I'm very happy for her. And I think she's number one for me when she sings in Italian language is perfect for me, for the interpretation and the voice. Her voice is wonderful, but I think this from 25 years ago, and I think she is an international singer, and I'm very happy for her, and I hope for her for this moment, very important for her, and she's my friend, and I'm very happy.
So let's see what Laura Pausini did with us when she was honored for Capri Hollywood. This was the first award she got with Diane Warren. And of course, I was talking about an Oscar nomination. So she's very superstitious. I don't know. And she look what she did when I said, you might be nominated. Diane, no matter, you are one of the legendary women in Hollywood. No matter, you are one of the most prolific composer. Can you believe that had to come a young Italian lady to make you win the Oscar? Because this year is the good time.
No, look, okay. Diane, some of your cross voice. Everything. Now cross everything, touching but, iron, because we don't know. We don't know. It's a cross. I mean,
I know.
Cross everything you can.
Yeah, cross my cat's tail too. I mean, I hope your Capri magic rubs off on us, on all of us. Hope it rubs off on me, because it would be nice. But I'm so proud of the song. Thank you, Laura. And Eduardo, Bonnie Greenberg, music supervisor who worked with me on this. It's such an honor to be part of this amazing movie. Am I supposed to be talking now?
Yeah. Sorry.
Oh, sorry. Okay. I'm not as articulate as all you guys, but this whole, just to be part of this movie is really an honor. I love the song so much. I love... people are responding to it. I love the movie, Sophia. I don't know. I don't know what to say, except this is what a great way to start the new year. And thank you. Thank you.
Laura, to be associated with the legend of the legend, Miss Sophia Loren. Now you are really a prima donna, because you in
not,
a proper
not a
way.
Prima
because,
donna.
Yeah, we know. In Italiano, it has not the same meaning of Americano, but a first lady. You are definitely a first lady.
A first
now.
Lady, yes.
Now, as I told you before, it's another big responsibility, first of all, because the song is. A step up from the message that Eduardo wanted to give to the movie, the whole movie. So we just wanted to be the voice of Sophia talking with Ibra, because Madame Rosa at this point of the movie is having a, not a chat, but something like very touching and special through the song, talking with Momo. And so this is touching, but especially thinking about giving a voice, singing to the icon, the only and the one and only Sophia is, I don't know what to say, because it's still so touching. So I'm so honored. And now that I'm here and I have to sing, I want to be as good as I can. I mean, the best of the best I can give to this song and to the movie and to Sofia and Eduardo and all the staff Dejan, Nicolò, Ibra, to let us shine. Not me, but the movie, the message. We are a family with a message to give. And so it is a responsibility that I want to take, and I want to do it at my best. When I speak with Dejan, and sometimes we're having interviews together, we always feel the same, like we built a family while you called us to be part of yours. So it is the same message that you want to give to the whole world through the movie. So it's so real that probably this is the meaning of what we are living today. People are receiving that.
Tu hai già detto che insomma sei emozionata, sei in quarantena, è un momento magico. Sono felice che anche la tua bambina stia vivendo questa forte emozione di una mamma così giovane, gagliarda, tutta Solarolo. Immagino il parroco di Solarolo che sta lì con le campane, sì, pronte. Mi ricordo che per la premiazione di Capri you started making like scongiuri. I wanted to bring a little cornicello for you today.
So, I have everything with me. I brought with me all the things from Italy that hopefully will give us luck. But yes, yes, of course, I have my bacchetta magica and also my Unipop, which is a cacca. Well, I have a wand, which is magical also a poo. A unicorn poop. But I want to show you. I want to show you the poop because it can be like horrible like to say, but it's very nice.
Laura, show us your poop.
That is a magical poop.
A big unicorn. That was a big unicorn.
It's a very colorful.
Big unicorn. You see that?
I need one of those. I need one. How do I get one of those?
Yes, let me send you one.
Ieri a Piazza del Popolo c'è stata una manifestazione alla quale hanno partecipato tutti i lavoratori dello spettacolo, coloro che lavorano in silenzio, dai datori delle luci alle security, dai mixer piuttosto, tutta la gente che fa in modo che lo spettacolo vada avanti. Ecco, cosa vogliamo dire a queste persone che guardano al futuro con speranza di poter ritornare presto sulla scena?
Ma non solo con speranza, adesso bisogna cominciare a fare qualcosa di concreto per loro, perché per noi non si sta lavorando nella musica da troppo tempo, gli spettacoli sono considerati come non un bene di necessità emozionale primario, e non trovo che sia giusto. E la manifestazione di ieri, ancora una volta, perché non è la prima che fanno Bauli in piazza, è stata importante secondo me, è stata un grido al governo cercando di sensibilizzare ancora una volta le persone che devono decidere di riaprire. Ovviamente in sicurezza, come tutti siamo da sempre pronti a rispettare, però adesso non si può più stare fermi. Molti di loro, alcuni di loro, dei ragazzi che c'erano ieri in piazza, sono i ragazzi che lavorano insieme a me, c'erano anche alcuni miei colleghi. Sono stata molto contenta di vederli lì. Io in quel momento ero in volo. E mi sono collegata dall'aereo e ho cercato di mettere delle storie sul mio Instagram per far vedere che cosa stava succedendo, e ovviamente sono con loro assolutamente al 100%.
Yeah.
dispiace.
Non si ricorda, vedi? Non si ricorda. Ma che è? Se uno invita le persone, senza dire la sorta, e vedi, c'è una soluzione.
Live from Hollywood with the eve of the longest eve for Laura Pausini and her father Fabrizio Pausini, who's joining us here in the studio. Let me welcome also the Oscar winning screenwriter and producer Nick Vallelonga, who's been serving this year Los Angeles, Italia, as the chairman. So we will talk with him shortly in order to close this section of work. So Fabrizio, insomma, che emozione è in questo momento? Diciamo una notte lunghissima sarà sì. Quest'oggi.
Proprio siamo arrivati ormai, quindi l'emozione cresce sempre di più. Non si dormirà né stanotte né domani e speriamo che vada tutto bene, così chiudo l'ultima pagina del libro, capito lì?
Certo, il famoso libro che tu hai detto. Insomma, ma tutta questa superstizione, questa scaramanzia, Laura, abbiamo visto quando a Capri ho accennato a dire doveva venire una signora italiana, cara Diane, per farti vincere dopo le 11 nomination all'Oscar.
Ah,
e lei ha cominciato a dire... Ah! E poi dopo
ho capito chi era la signora italiana, ecco.
E poi dopo adesso si è portata quell'oggettino molto colorato, sì. E la bacchetta magica da inserire nel suo vestito della Maison Valentino, hanno fatto il vestito con il taschino della bacchetta magica.
Apposta, sì, sì.
Ma da dove l'ha presa tutta questa superstizione?
Questo non lo so, io non sono superstizioso, quindi non so, forse con gli anni invecchiando
o frequentando tanti napoletani come me che insomma hanno, no?
Abbiamo anche la manager napoletana,
pure Fabrizia Cercello napoletana, sì. Quindi praticamente,
e quindi forse avete influenzato un poco,
ha trovato terreno fertile. Senti, con quale spirito Laura è partita per Los Angeles? Noi l'abbiamo vista parlare, già era arrivata proprio la stessa mattina, ma quando ti ha salutato qui cosa ti ha detto? Papà, vado, vinco e torno?
No, non ho detto vinco e torno, no. Si spera sempre, si spera quando si fa una gara, c'è una gara, c'è un vincitore, si spera sempre di vincere. E quindi io ho detto vai e spacca tutto, però è una cosa così, non è che deve vincere per forza. Già questo è un grande risultato e quindi poi se vince, il libro dice così, però finora è andato bene tutto, non ne ha sbagliata una. Tutti, adesso quando poi ci troveremo, se trovo il libro ti faccio vedere che quello che dicevo ieri.
Senti, Giuseppe Pedersoli, tuo papà Bud Spencer era superstizioso? Aveva dei amuleti speciali che portava con sé quando andavate a girare i film in tutto il mondo? Accendi il microfono, Giuseppe.
Non sentiamo.
Sì, ecco. Eccoci, sì.
Sì. Ok, mi sentite?
Sì.
Ok. No, era un napoletano anomalo in questo senso, perché era molto ottimista e non si faceva condizionare dalla scaramanzia. Vedeva sempre il lato positivo delle cose e quindi si metteva in gioco, non era superstizioso, no.
Insomma, era abbastanza sereno su questo fronte. Senti Marco, ma come si vive la vigilia di una grande prestazione, di una grande occasione? Tu hai vinto Sanremo due volte. Ecco, qual è lo stato d'animo con cui un artista che è lì che se la batte vive la vigilia? Marco, accendimi.
Intanto io devo ringraziare Fabrizio, perché non so se mi sentite e mi vedete.
Sì, tu ci senti? Mi senti?
Sì, mi sento.
Sì, ci siamo sentiti alcune volte. Vai pure tu.
ci siamo sentiti una volta per telefono, mi ha dato il nome di un grande otorino che mi ha salvato la vita praticamente.
Addirittura?
Sì.
Sono contento. Sì,
perché... Ti ricordi?
Sì, mi ricordo bene, mi ricordo. Ma io ti seguo da sempre, quando tutte le... Ti seguo da sempre, da quando le figlie tutte e due avevano il poster in camera tua, quando facevi i primi Sanremo con Disperato e poi con Masini, con Dati, ogni tanto ne parliamo insieme, quindi non ci siamo quasi mai visti di persona, se non in qualche concerto. In concerto, quando siamo venuti a Firenze, io stavo al mixer e tu eri lì dietro... E poi
gironzolavi,
e quindi comunque complimenti anche a te.
Grazie.
Tanti
grazie.
Complimenti anche a te.
Quindi, no, io dico che sì, che si prova un'emozione grandissima. Laura è riuscita a arrivare all'emozione massima e credo che sia un premio giusto. Per un artista che è sempre stata se stessa e che si è amministrata da un punto di vista artistico e da un punto di vista umano e privato anche, sempre con grande maestria e con grande lucidità. E questa è la cosa che secondo me può darti la garanzia di fare un percorso lungo e di arrivare là dove tanti altri non arrivano perché non riescono ad autogestirsi. Oltre al talento, che è innegabile ovviamente, perché Laura, io ho sentito Laura, ho avuto la fortuna di sentire Laura la prima volta a Modena quando stavano registrando La Solitudine, grazie a Valsiglio, il primo produttore, che mi fece ascoltare il pezzo prima che Laura andasse a Sanremo, quindi per me fu una novità. Appena sentì la sua voce, la sua interpretazione, ebbi l'intuito di capire che questa ragazza sarebbe andata lontano. Però vederla così lontano, per me come amico, come collega e come professionista in questo settore e come italiano, credo che sia una soddisfazione grandissima. L'emozione credo che sia unica, perché già si prova tanta emozione su un festival come quello di Sanremo, figuriamoci in un'occasione come questa.
Certo, certo. Senti Marco, ma quali sono diciamo tutte le accortezze che uno deve fare quando parte favorito, no? Ci si isola, qual è il modo in cui si gestisce tutta la pressione che arriva dall'esterno, ci si protegge, perché è evidente che si sente proprio, no? Che nell'aria è Fabrizio.
Si sente, come lo vive
Laura questi momenti di pressione?
Sì, molto, sempre molto tesa, quindi, ma tutti gli artisti che vanno su palchi importanti hanno questa... cosa qui è un fatto naturale, penso. L'emozione di salire su quel palco, insomma, è dura, quindi forte l'emozione e quindi, insomma, non è facile.
Anche lei non solo è lì per in nomination per Oscar, ma lei fa un performance.
Sì.
Ma io credo...
Ecco, vai Marco.
Io credo che chiunque arrivi a questi livelli viva la cosa con grande tensione, suspense, ansia ovviamente, ma che al momento che sale sul palco riesca a scaricare tutto quanto, a mantenere lucidità. Io vedo che Laura è sempre stata così, come tanti grandi artisti internazionali, e mi è successo anche a me, nel senso che anch'io, quando sono salito sul palco di Sanremo in un momento magari importante, forse nel 2004, quando comunque per me rappresentava qualcosa di importante per la mia strada, per la mia anche, tra virgolette, svolta artistica, io scaricai tutto quando salì sul palco. Nel momento in cui sali sul palco e riesci a mantenere la lucidità e la freddezza che deve avere chi trasmette emozioni per riuscire a trasmetterle meglio, quindi a viverle, ma a viverle in maniera molto lucida per poterle trasmettere agli altri, ecco che raggiunge il risultato. E Laura è così, almeno per quanto sì, la conosca io, e sicuramente
così è, così Marco
può confermare.
Certo, certo, confermo, confermo. Ti dico anche, poi sono i primi minuti quelli che poi dopo poi si prende in mano tutta la situazione e si parte. È solo il primo, quando sali la scaletta per andare sul palcoscenico, è quello il momento più, poi dopo il calore del pubblico ti fa rilassare un attimo e si riprende in mano la scena, è così.
E anche io sono grato, devo dire, questo Fabrizio, perché Laura è conosciuta di tanti negli Stati Uniti, ma non di tutti. E questa è un'opportunità per tante persone negli Stati Uniti, anche in tutto il mondo, per vedere il suo performance con una canzone bellissima.
Sì, infatti Laura Pausini comunque non è nuova all'America. Io ricordo già 10 anni fa che aveva cantato una canzone prodotta da David Foster per un film di uno dei suoi miti, a questo punto immagino, Kevin Costner. Sogno poi coronato avendolo ospite in studio con Paola Cortellesi nella bellissima trasmissione di Rai 1, Paola e Laura e Paola, Paola e Laura, non ricordo.
Era Message in a Bottle.
Message
in a Bottle, sì.
E quindi
il film, la canzone era One More Time.
One More Time, vedi, è la storia, papà, il papà di Laura Pausini, ragazzi.
Almeno quello.
Siamo davvero felici di vivere la vigilia di questa Oscar Night, dove Laura Pausini vivrà le stesse emozioni che ha vissuto, immagino, gelosissimo sarà stato suo marito Paolo quando è arrivato in studio, dello studio di Rai 1, Kevin Costner, che, diciamo la verità, è ancora un gran figaccione, e Laura e Paola, insomma, le vedevo abbastanza emozionate, no? Anche la mamma, immagino, a casa, no?
Penso di sì.
Non lo so. No, insomma, ricordo quindi che Laura corona proprio, come dire, un magico momento che dura tanti anni con l'America. Aveva vinto un Grammy latino, ma anche miglior Grammy americano con il miglior album pop latino. Perché Laura è veramente un'icona.
2006.
2006, esatto, infatti. No, mi sono nel frattempo informato meglio. No, no, perché
informo.
No, assolutamente. Mi ero informato, caro Fabrizio, bravo. Perché l'altra volta ci siamo collegati e ero sotto convinto. Ne avevamo parlato. Invece ho visto bene che il Grammy, quello vero, per capirci, perché ci sono i Grammy latini che sono limitati al mercato latinoamericano, invece poi ci sono i Grammy, quello che si dà a Los Angeles, allo Staples Center, Grammy, miglior album latino pop. Senti Marco, come si fa a tenere a bada tutta l'emozione per poter cantare bene? Perché per fortuna questa volta Laura non dovrà cantare in diretta, in quanto immagino pre-registreranno oggi o hanno già registrato ieri.
No, vabbè, ha detto che registrano dal vivo, cioè canta dal vivo, eh.
Cioè, non cantano dal, non penso, no, cantano contemporaneamente al, no, no, allora ho detto che no, registravano.
Fanno prima, durante il pre-show, le canzoni.
Fanno pre-show.
Durante il pre-show, stanno, during the, before the show, they're doing four of the nominated songs, and then the other Iceland song will be done during the broadcast, as I understand it. That's what our friends from the Hollywood Reporter and Giorgio from ABC told us. George, I'm saying George.
George Pennacchio, yes, the correspondent.
I'm saying Giorgio, because he's
Giorgio,
Italian.
No, George. No, so I don't understand. So, is she going to sing live during the night, or she's going to sing a little before or a little after? I don't understand.
Io penso che sia registrato. Penso che sia, però cantano dal vivo. Cantano dal vivo.
Sì, assolutamente, cantano dal vivo, ma questa occasione ho capito che verrà preregistrato perché devono farlo al museo dell'Academy.
Sì, infatti, cantano sopra, sul terrazzo, in alto, no? Sul tetto.
Infatti,
sul tetto.
Sì. Sotto questo design di Renzo Piano, questo nuovo parte del museo di cinema. È un bellissimo set. Ecco, questa parte rotonda, come ho capito, è un piccolo mistero, ma sembra come è lì e cantano e mettono le canzoni prima durante il pre-show, per cui si può vedere anche qui in Italia prima. Sì. La verità.
Infatti, all'Academy Museum, e dunque La lunga notte di Lalo Pausini, domenica 25 aprile, giornata in cui ricorre normalmente la liberazione dell'Italia, e giornata che festeggiamo sempre con il Presidente della Repubblica in prima linea. Immagino che festeggeranno in tutti i consolati italiani nel mondo, quindi anche il Consolato Generale di Los Angeles, diretto magistralmente dal console Silvia Chiave, che sarà lì in prima linea a tribolare insieme alla direttrice dell'Istituto Italiano di Cultura di Los Angeles, la signora Valeria Rumori, e la nuova direttrice dell'ICE, Alessandra Reinaldi. Insomma, tutta Los Angeles, tutta Hollywood è lì che soffre per Laura Pausini, insieme a Diane Warren e Nicolò Aiardi, dobbiamo ricordarlo, e anche immagino Sofia Loren ed Edoardo Ponti, perché comunque, diciamo la verità, tutto nasce da questo film. Sì. E poi naturalmente tutta l'Italia è lì che tifa anche per il Pinocchio di Matteo Garrone, anche se le quotazioni ai bookmakers di Pinocchio sono un po' complicate, perché per quanto riguarda i costumi c'è la già vincitrice di tre premi Oscar, Anne Roth, che ha fatto un film straordinario, mentre invece per il make-up potrebbe essere l'altra grande sorpresa italiana. Chissà, ma
sono bugie, Pinocchio.
Pinocchio, sono tutti gli... But we finish our live show 1 week long with our beloved chairman, Nick Vallelonga, who has been so patient. I love you so much, Nick. Let's show something of yesterday night, the final gala where you honored George Gallo as Italian America of the Year, and also you honored the director and the producer and the two actors of the Tunisian movie, who actually is running for best international film. We are really caring about this movie because Monica Bellucci is starring in it. So what a surprise would be if it would win. However, I think that is very complicated because Minari is on for this award. So I think that as Parasite was last year's surprise at the Oscar, this year's surprise might be Minari. However, so what's your feeling? This is just the last moment of this live from Hollywood show. Nick?
Well, I think, Pascal, what you did was amazing. I said it last night at the theater, that just to even get anything live, to have people in the seats, was fantastic. People were so excited. And last night we saw a comedy, and there's nothing better than to have people in the audience with a comedy. And it was filled with laughter, applause, cheering, crying. It was a great, great screening. And it's a testament to you, what you do every year. I don't know how you do it. It was hard enough for me to do it on a small scale. So congratulations to you, this festival. It's so amazing that we even got it on, but it went so well. People were so happy, and that's most important. We had people back in the theater together, laughing, talking about a film. So we owe you a big thank you, big, big thank you. And it sends a message to the world, to American cinema, to Italian cinema, that we're going to fight all this, and we're going to get strong and get better, and we're going to get back into the movies.
Nick, so what did you hear about the Italian nominated Laura Pausini and the Pinocchio people?
Well, I mean, who are we rooting for? It's the most beautiful song ever. It's an amazing song with amazing writers, production, singer, the combination of all of it. We're praying for it, and I feel so much in my heart that it's going to win.
So this is the moment that you honored George Gallo, the director. I hope you're gonna invite him to Ischia, where we're gonna have the festival on July 18, 25. We are watching on television you and George Gallo on stage of the Chinese Theater. One of the final images I remember to all the people who are in Los Angeles want to go to the Chinese Theater. What is the program today, Daniel?
There's two films being shown. The film Recon, which is with Franco Nero, who is a co-founder of the festival and part of the team. This is a thriller set at the end of World War II, directed by Robert David Port. And then we have the film. We talked with both the director and some of the cast yesterday, as well as the composer of Fatima. And that's at 6:30 p.m. in Los Angeles time. Marco Pontecorvo is the director. And that's a very interesting film that deals with the events, the visualization of the Blessed Mary in Fatima at the end of the First World War. But it's really a message of peace and transcendence.
So I want to say thank you to Nick, and of course we wait for him in Ischia, July 18, 25. I want to say thank to Giuseppe Pedersoli. You know, we make the Bud Spencer Award since his father died. Today we had here in the studio as our guest the first honoree of the Bud Spencer Award, Jack Houston. I'm very happy, and to follow this show, we're going to show Jack Houston interview today, and then of course I want to anticipate Marco Masini that he's going to be honored this year in Ischia Global, because he's a wonderful artist and he's one of our iconic musicians, and we really love him and we want for him the best. So I can announce today that Marco Masini is the first honoree of this year's Global Festival, starting from 18 until the 25th of July. Congratulations, Marco.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Marco.
Very good. And I want to congratulate, I'll take just a second here to congratulate Pascal Vici Domini for, in this time of crisis, doing a physical festival in Los Angeles, doing this week-long gathering of filmmakers, artists, musicians from all around the world in these very special meetings. It reminds me of his other festivals where people tend to meet at midnight, 1, 2 in the morning and start to talk. And it's been like that all week. And especially also for bringing Fabrizio Pausini in to help us all send our spirits and our love to Laura and give her her to have best wishes.
Thank you so much again to Nick. I love you, Nick. And I want to leave you guys with this video. Actually, is some of the footage that we have been taping since we started the Ischia Global Festival, which is actually the next appointment that we have on the schedule on July 18, 25. God bless Laura Pausini. God bless Pinocchio. God bless Italy and enjoy cinema. Ciao.